brethren of the past, those being the deceased prophets of old, and certainly all the apostles that came along afterwards. We thank God for them and for the word that they spoke. We certainly give due respect always to our leader, Pastor Jennings. Want you always to remember him in prayer. Due respect is also due to all the many, many ministers that are here. And there's many missing, but we thank God for them nonetheless. As you all know, we're here for no other reason but to hear the word of God. And it's the most important thing in our lives. And we do want to make sure that we gather it to ourselves, keeping in mind that the purpose of church, saints of God and listeners and viewers, is for the salvation of our souls and to get ourselves ready to meet God. Is that right? This life is a very temporary life. The life to come after this one will last much, much longer. So it behooves us to get ourselves ready by obeying the word of God. As is customary, we're going to actually call on a few of our brethren that we don't hear from too often that have traveled, and we ask for your patience concerning them. First of all, there is a brother, I do believe from Pennsylvania or maybe from New York, I'm not 100% sure, Minister Muhammad, if he's here. Minister Muhammad. Minister Farrakhan, I believe. Beg your pardon.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here today, to look upon the face of the saints once again. When I look on the face of the mothers, I think about my mother, what she used to tell me about Jesus Christ was God. And at that time, I was in the Nation of Islam, and I didn't believe that. I said, only thought Jesus was a prophet. But look how God had, look where God had brought me from. Look at me now. I wish my mother was living now that I could tell her, Mom, you was right. Jesus Christ is God, and I'm going to serve him with all my heart, with all my mind, and with all my soul. Not only he's God, but he's one God, one faith, and one baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. And thank you, brothers and sisters, for honoring me to listen to these words. May God be with you.
Thank God for Minister Farrakhan. I'm always very grateful for him. Continue to pray for him and for others, my God, that may be living in the location where he's from. Another minister that has been with us for some time and has been working very faithfully up in the Detroit area. He's now in Indiana, and that's Minister Etheridge.
Greetings, everyone. We greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus. We thank God for all his goodness and his mercy. We thank him for the prophets and the apostles that have gone on before. And certainly to Pastor Jennings, our present day leader and apostle, we thank God for him. We're thankful, saints, to be in the house of God, to hear the word of the Lord. I thank the Lord that we're living in a day now where we can truly say we have heard the preached word of God. You have a preacher in your midst, and we ought to thank the Lord for that. Men like this, you can count them on one hand and still have fingers to spare when you meet a man like this that stands up for the name of Jesus Christ and the word of God. The Lord is giving now the world the opportunity to hear the true gospel of Jesus Christ that truly saves men from their sins, tells a man, no, you're not all right, you need to repent of your sins and be baptized and watered in the name of Jesus Christ and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, the real Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost that causes people to be mindful of the word of God. The Holy Ghost that causes people to be faithful to the church, the real Holy Ghost. And so we ask that you continue to pray for the work and ministry that's going on in Detroit, Michigan, because it's not my right to be in the pulpit in Detroit or anywhere else. It is a privilege for me to be there. And I always get up before God's people with that mindset that it is not my right. It is a privilege for me to be there and teaching God's people in his stead. In his stead. So, saints of God, pray for the work in Detroit, that the Lord continue to do his work there with us and with the saints there who are laboring faithfully in the word of God. We ask that you pray for us much because we need the sincere prayers of the people of the Lord. Would you continue to keep us in prayer, and may the Lord richly bless you is our prayer. Peace be unto you.
All right, thank God for Minister Etheridge, working very faithfully up in the Detroit area. The work is growing tremendously there, so as always, we ask for your prayers concerning that. We're going to turn our attention to somebody that you do or you are familiar with and we have not heard from in a while. The minister from New Jersey.
Pastor Taylor.
Greetings, everyone.
Greetings.
It's an honor and a privilege to be here today. We thank God for the conference started on Thursday night, Friday night, and last night, and now we're here today. It's good to be here. We thank God for his mercy toward us. We could have been cut off and gone on into eternal judgment. We thank God for his mercy. Praise him. Without him, we can do nothing. Amen. Without him, we can't do nothing. So I'm grateful and I'm thankful to be here to be with the ministering brothers and to listen to our pastor. We had a very good minister meeting, and I'm so glad and so happy to see all the different talks and the different subjects and how everything came out good. Amen. My desire is to go all the way with the Lord. I thank God for the way of holiness. You must be holy. Amen. Praise him. We have to be like God because God is a holy God, and God wants his people to be holy as well. So we thank God for all the ministers, all the brothers. I met some that I never met before, and it was good to listen to them and hear them, amen, to talk about different subjects, and we're so happy and we are so grateful. Amen. New Brunswick, we're still there. We ain't going nowhere. We're still in New Brunswick. We ask for all the prayers of the saints that God will keep us. I want to keep my mind stayed on the Lord. I don't want to be just a teacher or preacher of the word. I want to live the word. I want to be an example. Glory be to God. Hallelujah to others. Pray my strength in the Lord.
Thank God for Pastor Taylor from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Keep him in prayer and the saints up there in that area. We're going to turn our attention to the Caribbean and ask Minister Baker to come up to give us a few words. Minister Baker.
Greetings, everyone.
Greetings.
Greet everyone in the name of Jesus Christ, the one God. We thank God for being here. Thank God for his mercies carrying us here in America to hear the word of God. You know, it's a great blessing and it's an honor to be in the presence of God and to witness a time like now where God has sent a God-sent man filled with the Holy Ghost to preach to us in these end times. And you know, it's an honor to be a part of it. And we don't want to just be here and let these words slip, as the word of God has said. But we want to garner it, take it into consideration, and apply it to our lives. We don't want to play church. But we want to make sure what we are doing, we are feeling and accepting the real thing. I want, when I come in church and hear the word of God, I don't move unless God moves me. I don't want to fake nothing. We don't want to be a hypocrite. But we want, when we move, the Spirit is moving us. Glory to God. That's what we want. Because this gospel that we are here listening is not a joke. You have false churches out there and people out there playing church, but this is not a joke gospel. This is the real stuff. And to be among all these elders and ministers, it's an honor. That's how I view it. I don't view it as just TV time. This is not my 5 or 10 minutes of fame, but this is about God. We travel all the way from Jamaica and come here. Why? Because we want to fellowship, as the scripture said, not forsaking the assembly of yourself, and most of all, to hear the word of God. That when we go back to Jamaica, we come back even better than when we left, to feed the people with the word of God. God bless you in Jesus Christ's name.
Thank God for Minister Baker from Kingston, Jamaica. Do remember the saints down there in the Caribbean, as always. Many of them can't make these trips, but nonetheless, we're all still one body. We're going to call on one other brother. There's so many to call on, we can't call on everybody. But we want to hear from Brother Phil, if he's here. Don't know if he's still here. Brother Phil? Brother Phil, all right.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. We are so grateful. I say many times, you never know what one is going through. Remember the sick. The Holy Ghost said, don't be slow to visit the sick. So you can make it your business, pray for the sick. I just assure you to God. I thanks about that. I say, Lord, I thank you. For a true apostle.
That's right.
I say a true apostle.
Yes.
Glory to God. I'm just thankful. This way is the right way.
That's right.
Ain't no other way. God is the way.
Yeah.
Glory to God. I'm just thankful. I'm overwhelmed, my God, with the knowledge that the Lord have given our apostle. Glory to God. Saints of God, keep it real. At all times, just ask God for strength to keep it real. Don't jump in a holy suit because you're going to a certain temple. Got to keep it real.
Yeah.
The Holy Ghost said, they that worship God must worship him, spirit and in truth. I ask that you will pray my strength in the Lord.
All right, thank God. We can't hear from all the brothers, but we're certainly grateful for those that we did hear from. As always, keep all the ministering brethren in prayer. As the work of God grows, you can see how big it's getting. Pray for each of the ministers everywhere. We'd just like to remind everyone again, you're listening to and watching the Worldwide Truth of God radio and television program coming to you from the First Church of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're located at 5105 North Fifth Street. That's North Fifth Street at Lindley Avenue in the city of Philadelphia here in Pennsylvania. In the United States of America, where our leader, teacher, and guide is the Apostle Pastor Gino Jennings. Mesdames et messieurs, bonjour, bonsoir, bonne nuit, à de la radio et de la télévision audience au nom de Jésus-Christ. Nous sommes la vérité de Dieu programme international avec le pasteur Gino Jennings. Saludos a todos nuestras audiencias de habla hispana de la radio y de la televisión. En el nombre de Jesucristo, este es el programa Verdad de Dios con el pastor Gino Jennings. Also like to remind you that you're actually listening to and witnessing, my God, another celebration, this being our 21st telecast anniversary. It's our 23rd International Youth Convocation, and we've reached another milestone in our radio broadcast, this being the 30th year that the Truth of God radio program has actually been on the air. We do have another few announcements for you very quickly. We would like you to take note of a change in our email address. Our new email address is firstchurch@truthofgod.com. This will be on television, on screen. New email address, firstchurch@truthofgod.com. For those wishing to be baptized after you hear the word of God preached, pricked in the heart, and you see the necessity, the need to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, you can send your email to baptism@truthofgod.com. Once again, baptism@truthofgod.com. Again, if you have biblical questions or concerns about the scriptures, again, send your questions directly to Pastor Jennings. Biblicalquestions@truthofgod.com is the email address. Once again, if you have a question about the scriptures, send it to biblicalquestions@truthofgod.com. Our phone number is still up and working. It's 1-888-231-2201. Once again, give us a quick call, 1-888-231-2201. Just want to remind you again real quick of our mailing address. It's 5105 North 5th Street, 5105 North 5th Street at Lindley Avenue in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The postal zip code, 19120. Now it's my honor to present unto you the servant of God and messenger of the Almighty God himself, the Apostle, Pastor Gino Jennings.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. You may be seated. We bear witness there is no God but one. There is no God with him. There is no God besides him. There is no God greater than him. There is no God equal to him. We associate none, absolutely none, to be with the one true living God. God is not a painting on your wall, in your church, or in your house. God is eternal. God is everlasting. He know all things. We thank him for the prophets and the apostles. We thank him for the way of holiness. We thank God for all of you that are here. We're glad for all of our ministers and all of our guests, to our viewers that are watching around the world. This is the program that upsets your pastor, makes him get a job and go to work and stop robbing your church. This is the program that the devil hates because we believe what's written in the scriptures, not philosophy, not ideology. We believe what's written in the scriptures. And when you believe what's in the scriptures, brother, it's enough there to get you straight. Now we have some guests that are here, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. We're gonna kind of have a rap session this morning, this afternoon, and tonight. And I'm glad for our guests being present. We thank God for them. This is our youth conference. And we have thousands of young people in America, Canada, Africa, Europe, throughout the Caribbean, India, Asia, that are watching live now. But there's a common problem that is taking place not only here in America but abroad, and that problem is sin. And sin come in many forms and many shapes. And one thing about sin, it is hard to get rid of. Trying to do it on your own, you will never get it done. The only one that can truly combat sin is God himself. I'm glad for the visitors being here and how forthcoming that they're willing to be. I'm glad for my brother, Deacon Jennings, in talking to the brothers. And they're willing to share their experiences. And thank you, brother. They're willing to share their experiences with our viewing audience, and we're going to give them, and they have an international audience today. And many of our young people are dealing with what we're going to discuss, and that is about drugs. Now, you can leave that open, sister. Now, our young people, boys, girls, fathers, husbands, mothers, this device have tore down homes, have dissolved marriages, have killed children, have made people destroy themselves. And I'm glad for these brothers being here to give us a broader perspective and a realistic look. And I don't want them to hold no punches, because our preaching is very raw. And one thing I say about sin, it's very raw. So we're going to have a rap session and Garland Border. Come on and have a seat, brother. Jamal Bates, you can come on and have a seat. Yes, sir. John Fuller. Sharif Boyd. Maurice Williams. And Brother Salam. Salim, is he here? Brother Salim. All right. We need another microphone, another handheld mic, please. I need one. Where is it, brother? Is it already on the chair? All right, get that microphone for it, brother, for Brother Salim. Take that off and unwrap that and give it to the brother. How are you brothers doing? We appreciate y'all taking the time out to come. Give that to the brother, please. All right. We want to give you a background, a little background, or we'll let them do it. To give us a background about themselves. And because their background is a present thing amongst many brothers and sisters and even church people. Oh, yes. This is not just something that have been dealt with in the street. It have came in the church, and the problem with church people, they try to shout around it. And the preachers try to overlook it, but this is reality. So my first brother I'm going to introduce, and he can introduce himself, is Brother Maurice Williams. Yes.
How you doing today?
Let's turn all the microphones up, please. All the volumes up. All right, brother. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is Maurice Williams. I'm from the Mantua section of West Philadelphia. I was born and raised there. Just to tell you a little bit about myself, I went to prison at age 13 for taking someone's life. And what played a part in me taking someone's life was the fact that I was high on drugs, codeine and marijuana. And to this very day, I don't just have a dislike for drugs, I have a disdain for it. And many people that I know, family members, friends, every last one that I know that was murdered were all high on drugs, every last one of them. One of them was my brother, and two of them were my cousins. And I was invited here today by Mr. Jennings to just speak generally about my life and the things that I've gone through. And to come from a neighborhood where, if anyone know where the Mantua section in Philadelphia is at, they know what that neighborhood was like in the 90s, and they know what it is like now. Mm-hmm. And one of the biggest things that dominates that area is still drugs and crime and violence that none of us should be used to tolerating.
Yeah.
Although some of us get used to it and we accept it as being normal. Mm-hmm. And as I look on this side and see a lot of the elders, you know, it kind of makes me think of my grandmother.
Yeah.
You know, that passed away on April 21st, 2016, 2 years prior to me coming home. And she used to always tell me, you know, about the different things, the different people to associate with. And one of the things that saved my life prior to going to prison was she asked me to feed her dog one day. And I didn't like feeding the dog because the dog used to jump on me, you know. So she said, if you leave my house, don't ever come back. Mm-hmm. And right as I was feeding the dog, that time frame kept me from being murdered because I witnessed two of my best friends be shot 13 times. And they were 13 and 15. And that was March 30th of 1995. And I was later arrested about 9 months after that, 6 months after that. And to this day, I understand that, you know, you have to play a part in building a community. You can't just talk about it. You know, you can't just have gatherings and,
true.
You know, get people together and just talk about it. Because I'm pretty sure most people in here would either know someone or have a child, a mother, a brother, a father that has gone into the system and may be languishing there to this day, or may have been there and came back and have a great story to tell. Mm-hmm. I don't know many. I was recently released 6 months ago after doing 23 years. And I went to prison, like I said, at age 13. I was closer to 12 than I was to 14. And some people think that it's unrealistic for that to take place, that a 13-year-old child can go to prison. Granted, I've done something wrong to get there. And I'm a firm believer that punishment should be in place for anyone who does something wrong, especially something as heinous as taking a life. However, I don't think it should be anyone that agree that a child goes to prison for the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. Because I was sentenced to die in prison at age 13. And I think it doesn't affect you until it affects you personally. When it's your child.
Yeah.
When it's your daughter.
Right.
That's when you really care about it. Mm-hmm. When it's something that's distant from you, it's like, not my problem. But eventually it will become your problem. Then it may be too late to fix the problem. So my story, you know, is I don't think unique. I think I was the youngest in the state's history to go to prison at that age and be sentenced to a life without parole sentence. And I believe I'm the youngest on the street that came home after being sentenced to a life without parole sentence due to a law that changed in 2012 that the U.S. Supreme Court deemed to be unconstitutional to sentence people that were 17 and under to die in prison. And I just think that if anyone can imagine being a kid and you making the worst mistake of your life and being told to go to your room for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. It's unfathomable. So now that I'm out, some of the things that I enjoy doing is this, telling my story. I normally like to talk to kids. That's between 15 and 17, 13, you know, people that I can reach out to that have a troubled childhood. Mm-hmm. Or a mother or a father, like recently I just was up Southwest Philadelphia with Mr. Jennings, and they had wanted me to speak to a 12-year-old, you know, kid that was having some real issues that was on the road to entering the prison system. And I took about an hour of my time to sit down, you know, talk to them free of charge, no, you know, because I understand how easy it is to get into an environment and people forget about you.
Right.
And how hard it is to get out of that environment,
right?
You know? And one of the things that, you know, many people that I deal with don't understand is that when you come out of that environment, you come out damaged, extremely damaged. Mm-hmm. And it takes society to understand that when you go in as a youth and come out with a full beard, you look like a man, but you still got a lot of kid in you. And you force to leave that kid to the side because you don't get no more mistakes. If I make that mistake, I can't even call it a mistake. Mm-hmm. If I commit that crime that I did back at age of 13 now, the death penalty is the only option. So my hopes is that any youth that are here today anyone that, even if you have a good child, maybe they have a friend that's not so good, or maybe they have, you know, classmates, whatever the case may be, where you can hear someone like me speak and tell a story like, there was a guy that I met today or seen speak today, that it may seem unrealistic, that went to prison at age 13 years old and was sentenced to die in prison. And I remember my judge, Eugene H. Clark, who passed away in 1998, he said to me, it's a mystery as to how you got in my courtroom, but I have no choice but to sentence you to die in prison. He says, it's not something that I want to do, but the law says I have to do it. And there's a lot of reform that's, you know, that's taking place now in regards to prison reform. But the best reform starts in your household. Don't wait to go to prison and then start reaching out, because there's a lot of volunteers, mm-hmm. pastors, preachers, imam, that come to prisons. Do it now.
Right.
Don't wait till they get there, because they may never get out of there to help with what people like yourself may go in to help with. Mm-hmm. Because what happens is, a lot of people, when they make a mistake, they become spiritual. Because they don't feel good. You right. know, they feel like, ah, that was bad. I need to fix this. Mm-hmm. Fix it now before it's too late, whether it be by death or it be by you being physically incapacitated for the rest of your life behind a wall.
Right.
So it's not many people, because we was the only nation on earth that sentenced kids to die in prison. Somalia was the only nation, and they just banned theirs about 3 years ago. So we the most civilized, as it's constantly narrated. You know, we the most civilized, we the most industrialized, the most richest nation that, you know, mankind has ever seen, as, you know, people say, news outlets say. But for some reason, we got the highest drug rates. We got the highest drug out of all the industrial nations combined. We take more drugs than all the industrial nations combined. And this is a fact. And you wonder why. I think that a lot of us hate our reality. They don't like the condition that they're in. But it's up to people like myself and these guys up here who know some, not everything, we know some things that can change some things. Then it's people, you know, like people who have faith and people who go out and preach and people who go out and teach. You have a job as well. Mm-hmm. If everybody just stuck to themselves and said, I'm just taking care of me and my family, that's a problem. But no doubt you have to take care of your home front first. But there's a problem that exists amongst youth, and it may be something that's passed down from parents. You know, my mother died when she was 38 years old from liver disease. So I never really got a chance to know what she liked, what she disliked, you know? So in saying that, I say that to say this, I was left to my grandmother's care, who was already in her 70s. There was no way she could keep up with a kid. She tried, and I never got the opportunity to come and look at my grandmother and say, thank you for trying. Because when I left, you never knew what love was. You're a kid, you just want to go outside and play.
Right.
You know. So for any of the youth that's here, appreciate your parents, appreciate your mother, appreciate your grandma.
Hold that thought a minute, Brother Maurice, because I want to come back to you, because it's a very important statement you made, and what I want to ask you about in reference to using drugs as a form of escape. And I want all of you to get a chance to enlarge on that. I want to go to Brother Salim. Thank you for coming, brother.
Yeah,
I want you to get a chance to introduce yourself as well. This is the microphone that was on the stand. Please, let's turn them up. Come on, brother.
I'm going to use this one.
All right.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for having me, sir.
Thank you for being here.
My name is Vincent Becton, and I was convicted of murder at 16. I was sentenced to life in prison, meaning that I was supposed to stay in there and never go home again, never get to share dinner with my family or take a nice bath or shower longer than 15 minutes what I had to endure in there. I'm not making no excuses or nothing like that. It's not like I was a goody two-shoes. I come from a good mom and pop. My father was working for Conrail and the train at that time, and my mother used to work at Whitman's Candy Factory, and they owned a variety store, so I came from a good background. But I'm gonna say to all you youth out there, and excuse me, ladies, I was up against the biggest whore that it is, the streets, which is always open for anybody. They never turn their back. They is always open for you to come into the streets. But the reality of the fact is, you really don't know what you're gonna encounter. You really don't know. You might think you know, but you really don't know.
Well said.
You really don't know what you encounter. Because at that time, when I was sentenced, I didn't know what I was sentenced to. I knew I had a lot of time to do, but I didn't know that they sentenced me to never come home again, to never have dinner with my family or walk the streets or just having a nice cup of cold glass of water with some ice cubes. You know, something that we take for granted because something that we do every day. Like I said, and when I was sentenced, one of the hardest things I had to do, I'll never forget, I was at Holmesburg Prison, which they closed down now. They have CFCF, which they had in place of Holmesburg. And my parents came to see me, and one of the hardest things I had to do is tell my mother and father, excuse me, tell my parents that it was nothing that they could have done to stop me from what I was embarking on, being disobedient to my parents, not listening to them, not wanting to come home and take my school clothes off and be in when the street lights turn dark, wanting to be an adult, so I thought. Didn't have no clue. But anyway, when my parents came to see me at Holmesburg Prison, I had to tell my mom and pop, it's nothing that you could have done or said to save me because you gave me the best. You gave me the best that what a parents can do. And I had to explain to them that they was going up against the street. They didn't have no clue. They was once young, my age, but they didn't have no clue. And like I say, you know, for a lot of y'all out there, you know, the streets will accept you. I don't care what you do, I don't care what you say, they are always open. But you will come to understand that the penitentiary, which is jailed, state penitentiary, is never closed. They will close a school down before they will close the penitentiary down.
That's right.
They will close a school down. They will close the school down before they close the penitentiary down. At that time when I was incarcerated, it cost the taxpayer citizens about $34,000 a year to feed and clothe me. Which I said to myself as I got older, wow, they could have sent me to college or something. I get it, but no, that's not how I go. That's not how I go. They saying at that time I was worth nothing. And then for 35 years, I was incarcerated. For 35 years at the age of 16, I was making my grave up, which I call my bed, every day, proudly, not realizing like, dag, I'm gonna die in here. And then my mother became sick with breast cancer. And of course, you know, your parents and when your family come visit you in there, they want you to think everything is good. But everything is not good. You know, I mean, they try to hold up and tell you everything is good and they ask you, how's you going? But the reality of fact, you're not doing well in there. You're not doing well in there. You try to explain to them as best you can at 16 or 17 years old, oh, I'm doing all right, everything all right. But everything's not all right. Realistically, everything is not all right. But I will say this, you know, to all the youth out there, them streets is not what you think it is, man. And unfortunately, you don't realize until you pay the price. You know, until you pay the price of realizing like, wow, I'm never going home. You know, me and Vincent Boyd, the guy right here, me and him were cellies for about 14 years together in a box. 14 years together, me and him having to endure smelling each other, urine, feces, and all that. You know, that was my cellie. We grew up together. We was brothers for real. We grew up together. And at that time, we were sentenced to Huntington. It's located in central Pennsylvania. And in rural central Pennsylvania. And where we were sentenced at, our cells at that time was right across the street from a regular family house. We can look and see them having dinner, see the lieutenant come out and walk his dog, and see them wash the car. All the things we hope, like, dang, man, I wonder what that feel like to wash the car again. I wonder what that feel like to walk across the street again. We endured that and dealt with that for the most part. But when my mother became sick with breast cancer, and my family, of course, they didn't want to tell me, you know, because they know I was dealing with enough stuff. So eventually she got real sick where they had to tell me. And so when she died, I was not able to go to the funeral because at that time, a life prisoner, he can't go to the funeral because their rules and regulations, no, you can't go. You can't go. You're too dangerous. I'm saying, I'm dangerous. This is my first crime ever. I understand this is the severe crime, murder, but I'm like, wow, they won't even let me go see my mother Barry? Won't even let me look at her in a coffin? I'm like, wow. So when that passed, when she passed, you know, my father became old. And you know, your family start getting old. You know, you start realize, you start seeing nieces and nephews that you only knew through pictures. You really didn't know them. You know them through a visiting room, maybe if they take the time out to come see you. Because some family disown you. Because they say, wow, you did that? They disown you, not realizing at the end of the day, that's all you have is family. We're not gonna see eye to eye on everything, but at the end of the day, we don't pick and choose our family. Our family is all we have, man. And you know, I say to myself, I said, wow. When they changed the law and I was able to be resentenced in front of Judge Catherine Schreeder Jones, and when they brought me down to court, I was like, I didn't believe it, that it was happening, that I'm actually going home. I'm actually gonna be resentenced. And so when they brought me down to prison, of course I couldn't eat nothing. My nerves was bad, I was shot, because I didn't believe that this was happening. And so when I got in front of Catherine Schreeder Lewis, she sentenced me. She said, young man, you may approach the bench now. I'm gonna resentence you. You know, she said, I'm gonna sentence you to 35 years to life. And at that time I had 35 years in, and my knees buckled. And all my family started crying in the court. And I said to myself, why is they doing that? They know I'm gonna start crying. But it was tears of joy. But at the same time, it was tears of pain because I knew my victim. You know, it's not like I didn't know him, I knew him. Because like I told you, my family had a variety store. And they used to come in my store and stuff like that and shop and help, you know, my family. They, you know, help in the community. And I was like, wow. But anyway, I was resentenced. And when I was resentenced to 35 years of life, I said, wow, I'm actually going home. And when I was coming back to Greatestford, SCI Greatestford, I didn't believe it. I was just in the van crying. I said, wow, I'm going home and sit down and have dinner with my family. You know, having face-to-face talk with my family. I'm going to have dinner. I said, I'm going to see the refrigerator open up again. The light turn white, a light, come on. And so them things happened. But fast forward, I've been out now about 15 months.
Wonderful.
And every... Every day is a challenge, meaning that it's a challenge for me because when I come out my lawn and I look, I say, I'm actually free. I really don't believe it sometimes. I say, I'm actually free. You know, and then to purchase a phone and have money in my pocket, you know, because being incarcerated, you can't have money in your pockets. That's contraband. And they took all our street clothes because all of us wore browns. So I was like, wow, I got street clothes. I could go to the store and buy a piece of cake. I could go to the store and get me a Mountain Dew soda. I could go and get me a Welch's grape soda. You know, I still didn't believe it. I used to get at the counter at the store sometime and get stuck. And they'd be like, sir. I'd be like, oh. And dig in my pocket and pull out a $5 bill. And then a few times I could forget my change because incarcerated, everything when you go to store is by a paper that you just fill out. And so a few times I forgot my, you know, change. The lady or sir called me back, sir, your change. Okay. And I was like, wow. But I knew in coming home, I knew it was going to be a challenge for me. So I went to the halfway house, which is down 8th and Callahill. And I never forget, I used to go to Burger King. And just so I can get readjusted to seeing, dealing with everyday people. Mm-hmm. You know, seeing how people say thank you and no thank you. And what was something to me, how it seemed like, I don't know everybody, but it seemed like people is just so angry. I understand people been through things in life, but I say, wow, why are these people so angry? If they only knew, you know, the things they take for granted. If they only knew. But then, you know, like I said, as time went on, and some of the hard adjustments sometimes for me is dealing with my family, meaning that knowing that they grew up without me. And I grew up without them, being around men all day. And so, you know, it's a challenging, but it's a good challenge. I wouldn't trade them for nothing in the world. It's a good challenge, being around family, having dinner, you know, getting to take a bath, you know. And I will close with this. Just day before yesterday, I come from work. And so me and my supervisor was talking, and she was telling me, she said, Salim, you know, I bought something out the store. I said, well, what did you buy? She said, I bought these things they call bath bombs, like they explode up in the bathtub. I said, for real? I said, wow. I said, I want to get one of them. I want to, you know, I want to see what that feel like. So I got on the 10 trolley, got off at 15th Street, and went through the underpass and stuff, and got off and walked up there. Me and Sharif was together, matter of fact. We took the 34, and so I got off at 15th Street. And I got off, and I'll never forget, it was at 1525 Walnut Street. That's where the store called Lush, I believe. I went in there, and when I went in there, I was like, wow, smelling all these different fragrances. So I went in there, and the lady was like, may I help you, sir? I said, well, miss, no disrespect. I said, I want to buy the bath bomb, I think it called. She said, oh, okay. So she gave me different ones to smell. I said, I want that one right there. She said, okay. I said, yes, give me two of them. I want two of them. So I went home Friday, matter of fact, yesterday. I went home, and man, I took a bath, man. That felt so good, man. Like, wow. I was just in the bathtub. I just started crying. I said, Dad, I'm actually getting a chance to do this. And it was just something, man. But that's all that. All I have to say is be thankful, man. Be thankful.
Thank you, Brother Saleh.
Never, never take nothing in life for granted. Never. Never take nothing in life for granted. When you eat your legs, your eyes, you have to see, never take anything for granted, because a blink of an eye, things can change. A blink of an eye, just blink your eyes. Just blink your eyes, and things can change. But I want to thank you all for having me, and hopefully I was able to reach somebody, you know, to just, I know I'm not going to reach everybody, but I will say this. I'm living proof that dreams do come true. Dreams do come true. And I want to say, in closing, just be thankful, man. Hug your mother, hug your father, hug your brother. Just speak to your neighbor, man. Never take nothing for granted. Nothing. And one of the major things to me, when I went out last week, my brother wasn't home, he was at work. He said, well, what you gonna do, bro? I said, you know what? I still got some time before I go to work. I'm gonna sweep outside. And that was such a good feeling. I swept outside and sat on the doorstep and opened, I had a Mountain Dew soda. Once again, opened me a Mountain Dew soda up and just sat there and was crying, man. But I wanna thank you all. And hopefully I get a chance to talk to you all again. But don't take nothing for granted, man. Enjoy life while you have it. Enjoy life while you have it.
Thank you, brother. Yeah. Now, this is Brother Sharif Boy. Before I get to Brother Sharif, this is something I want to say to you that are here and to our television audience. Have you noticed that Brother Maurice and Brother Salim, the things that they were saying, have you noticed they made reference to the value of common everyday things? Eating, taking a bath, a soda, things that you take for granted now. And I hope our young brothers and sisters that are watching internationally are listening very close. Because the objective of these brothers being here, our young generation need to wake up bad. They are being coerced. They are being coerced not only in the neighborhood that they're in, but social media is doing such a damage to our young brothers and young sisters. Salim made a statement that really stuck out to me. When he went inside Burger King, and he was wondering, why is everybody so angry? This has become a mean society. What contributes to self-hate starts with hating God. God will teach you how to love self, but you can't learn how to love self until you learn how to love Him. And the understanding of Him will give you an understanding and a better appreciation for life. What do you mean, learn God? Sometimes we learn God through the characteristics of a good mother, or a good father. But the common things that the brothers have mentioned so far, you know, some things may tickle you, like those bath things he mentioned. Sweeping a sidewalk. How it feel good to sweep a sidewalk. Basically, what they're telling you is the common everyday things, a lot of time we understand the value of it too late. And what these brothers are trying to enforce in you is to understand and appreciate it now before it's taken away from you. All right, Brother Sharif Boyd, my brother, get a chance to introduce himself.
My name is Vincent Sharif Boyd. I went to jail at the age of 16. And my crime was a crime of ugliness. You know, we took a man's life. But I share with you, as Salim did, and as the big fella did, I had a mother and father. All my sisters, most of my sisters and brothers was old enough to be my mother and father. My mom had me when she was 43, so I was her baby. So when Salim and when other gentlemen speak about the streets, they suck us up. We didn't know no better. We are a society now that know better, and we still ain't doing nothing about it. You know, I cry all the time to myself because I came from a good family and went to a dark side. That dark side was incarceration for 36 years, you know. Fortunately, I lost my father in 90. I made it to the funeral. I lost my mother in 95. I made it to the funeral. So I was blessed to see them when they left me. But when I speak about education, being miseducated, not knowing, you know, and this is what the society is doing to us today with these phones and things. I went to jail illiterate. I couldn't read or write. My girl, my woman, my friend is in the back right now, and when she wrote me, I had to ask somebody to help me read that letter. So the struggles of what we've been through and what the youth are facing and going through is still real today. So what we have to do, what we need to do, and what everybody's saying is love yourself so you can love everyone else. See, when you love you, I ain't got no problem speaking to you, brother.
That's right.
I ain't got no problem saying I love you. I ain't got no problem saying, can I help you? But we don't do it enough. We don't do it at all sometimes. So my education, like I said, I couldn't read right. It took me 21 years to get my GED. And when I got it, I felt good. And I went from far and far away. I got an apprenticeship in baking. I got an apprenticeship in cooking. You know, I'm certified by Nockley in the food industry. I just don't want to do it no more. I love doing what I'm doing right now, talking. I love wanting to help the youth. But they don't want us to do this. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm about compassion. I want to help anybody. I go downtown every day with tears in my eyes when I see the homeless. You know, I say to y'all, sincerely, we got work to do, we got work to do, we got work to do. Because if we don't do it, my brothers was on drugs, my sisters was on drugs, you know what I mean? Smoking, some of the stuff that we see today, we never seen. Being away, we don't know nothing about that. When they sent us to that mountain in 1983, when he said Huntington, it was a whole different world. We were babies. 18 years old, didn't know nothing, but they made us men. They made us understand life. They made us be bitter. They made us cry. They made us laugh. I became a referee and didn't know how to read or write. I roughed every sport it was, but I was blessed to be free again. I was blessed to be here with Salim again. I was blessed to be here with all of y'all again. And you know what it is? It's a blessing. And I'm thankful and grateful because life is beautiful. You know, like you said, you walk out the door every day. I'm gonna tell a story like they did. Currency It's something you got to learn about. Mm-hmm. Me and a friend of mine went out to get something to eat. I brought two pizzas, a cheese pizza and a pizza that had something on it. But it was, and the lady said $6.75. I said, $6.75? She said, yes, so you want something to drink? I said, no. She said, water is free. I said, give me two of them. But when I went to jail, pizza was 50 cents. So after 36 years, things changed, you know? And like being mad, that's what happened. When I came home, in the prison, in the penitentiary, when somebody bump you, they break their neck and say, excuse me. When you get on that L or that sub, you get knocked every way. And you know, to be honest with you, you're going to raise your hands because mm-hmm. we come from a world
right.
of darkness for real.
Right.
We come from a world of protecting ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate to say it when I speak to the youth, but penitentiary is real.
Right.
And when I talk to them, if it was just a group of men, I would count down. 1, 2, 3, you're going to the penitentiary. 1, 2, 3, you're going to the penitentiary because the numbers and the statistics show it. You know, and it's sad to say, when I went to jail, it was 7 penitentiaries. Now there's 28 and counting. So that is just let you know that this design is real, but it's breakable.
Mm-hmm.
And we are here showing you that it's breakable. Right now, there's some things out there that's going on that to help men and women. I got to say women because there's some women that's home too. I would love to have one of them up here.
Oh,
you know what I mean? But life is beautiful. I've got two jobs. Do I like them? No, but I appreciate them. You know what I mean? I got jobs and I got learning about bills. We ain't know nothing about bills when we was away. They washed our clothes and made sure we was fine. But we got bills to pay now. We got cars. Some of us got homes. And believe me, we enjoy having those things. Because when we lay in that bed and wished and wished and wished, and the Lord then opened the doors for us to be here, our dreams then came true. You know what I mean? Be thankful. Be proud. I love people. You know what I mean? I love people, and I want y'all to really, really understand. Life is precious. Tomorrow ain't promised to you. We all know. We go to funerals every other week, seem like, don't we? Somebody passing away. So the word love, use it in the right way. The youth in this audience, love your parents. I don't care if your father on drugs. I don't care if your mom on drugs. When you see them, hug them. Because that conversation might be the breaking point. You know, we are powerful individuals, but we don't know our power until it's too late. You know what I mean? We don't know who we are until it's too late. Because one thing we have is a conscience. And our conscience has been with us since we knew how to say thank you. And if you listen to your conscience, you will always be fine. You know, I can go on and on, but I just want to thank y'all as those two did. And if any questions come about, I am so happy to answer them. And I'm going to pass this mic on. Thank
you. Yes, sir. Thank you, Brother. Yeah. After the brothers, all of them get a chance to introduce themselves, and then we'll get a chance to present some questions to the brothers. And don't be afraid to be direct, to paint the most realist picture of reality that could be painted. Because one thing that we don't believe in is mythology. Because life is not a myth, life is real. All right, Brother Garland. Which one is Brother Garland? Yes, sir.
How y'all doing? Thanks for having us here. I'm gonna switch the page a little bit. I too was certified when I was 16 and went upstate,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I didn't do as much time as you did. Instead, my dumb ass, excuse me, but I come out on parole. So I'm in and out. Then I got into the drug thing, you know, and I've been an addict for the last 15 years. But, you know, now I'm in treatment, you know, thanks to Dr. Jennings and his clinic.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I'm a member of the church also. I go to Sharon Baptist now, my mom's church. But it's really rough because I really destroyed myself, not just from jail, but from these streets also. Because I'm diabetic now, I got high blood pressure. You know, I can say today I'm clean, you know. But I too came from a good home. My mom worked for the post office for 40 years. My dad had his own business. And you wonder how this happened. You know, I ran the street with the gang and all this. I did everything, you know, my mother told me not to do, I did. I just did everything wrong, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? But I'm happy to be here with y'all today. I'm happy to be clean today. It, like the brother said, it's a pleasure to be out here. The young ones, I don't know, I started with smoking weed. Now they call it loud and all this stuff. But this is how I started. And the next thing you know, I'm snorting dope, I'm snorting coke, you know, and this just happened overnight, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? But when I say overnight, I mean it. Look back, it's 15 years now I've been messing around, you know? But you get tired, and I am. I'm at that point now. That's, you okay. know, that's why I'm here today. I'm gonna keep it short and sweet.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
It's a better life.
Yes, sir. Glad to have you, Brother God. Brother Jamal Bates.
How y'all doing today? My name is Jamal Bates. Like these fellas, I had spent time in jail. 15 years of my life has just been erased from me. It's something I can never get back. When I was young, I was raised with a nice mother and father. It's something that you don't see today. You know, there's not enough structure with these youth today. It's not a household with mother and fathers there. Mm-hmm. You know, my family, it was a good family, so I thought. You know, I was raised in the drug game with my family. It was something that we had to do, you know. And from there, my role models became drug dealers, the people that I despise now, you know. I mean, I had to learn how to cut heroin, bag heroin. That was one of my, if we didn't do it, we was punished, you know. So I was forced by my family to do this. You know,
you was punished by your relatives if you didn't learn how to cut heroin.
Yeah, that was a punishment. If we wow. cut it wrong, we would get whoopings from the oldest to the youngest.
Was this by mother or father?
Father.
By father?
Father, you know.
All right.
I mean, but my mother allowed it. Mm-hmm. But as I grew older, I see why she allowed it, because she was getting abused.
Okay.
If she said something, she would get hit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, she did what she could do until she got us out of that. Last night I watched Moses, and he was talking about bondage. You know, being bondage into a family where you being abused. Mm-hmm. You know, until my mom got the strength to break from that bondage. You know, but then we moved down Southwest. We was from South Philly. We moved to Southwest, where I see more drug dealers now. The JBM, growing up in that area. So these were idolized. You know, I kind of left the home structure and went to the streets mm-hmm. for love. You know, think I can receive love from the streets. I mean, they gave me artificial love.
Right.
You know, it wasn't a home structure love. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought the streets was my friends. The people that I was around was my friends. They was only come to kill, to destroy. Any dreams that I had of being a real man, you know what I'm saying? And so I got sentenced at 15. I went upstate. 15 years went away like that. I come home. Family members is gone, friends is gone. And I look on the streets today, and I overheard a guy saying, they're breeding animals. The people are animals out here now. They're mm-hmm. killing each other at a fast rate. I go around the corner and 3 murders within 1 week. You know, I see this every day. You know, like, what can I do to put my 2 cents to help this community, you know what I'm saying, to strive for better? Mm-hmm. What can I say to these people? I mean, Dr. Jennings asked me to come speak, so I ran through it. You know, try to change my life. Yeah, I struggle sometimes because they say the flesh is weak. My right. flesh get weak every day, you know, but it's up to me to keep striving on to see a greater picture, you know. So, I mean, like, I'm new to this.
Yes, sir.
I just want to learn, and I'm willing to learn, you know what I'm saying? So I don't go back to them places that I went up top in the mountains, because the congregate, we couldn't even congregate. We'll get broken up or go to the hole for congregating. Mm. 5 more in a room offering prayer.
So when you say that you will be sent to the hole, if it's just 5 or more.
5 or more?
Describe the hole.
No commissary, no food, just sitting in a room. You come out, take a shower once a day, probably, if you get the chance to get to your door quick enough.
Is it a certain length of time that they will put you in the hole?
Depends, whatever they sentence. I mean, they can do 6 months, they do a year. I know people that have been in a hole for 5-6 years.
And the hole is not like a regular prison cell, is it?
No, it's not. It's designed to break you.
Is it considered smaller than a prison cell?
It could be same size as a prison cell, but it is designed not to have no comforts, no TV, no nothing, no communicating, no mail, no phone calls, no nothing.
No dialogue, nothing.
You there with your Bible, your Quran, and all you got is prayer. All you can do is pray.
Interesting.
Pray to break me from this bondage that I'm in. You know, some people do come out, some people don't. You know, I mean, every day is a learning lesson.
Yes, sir.
You know, I will never forget now, because I'm still on parole to 2028. When I got this guy coming to my house every month to take a urine, you know, it's something I got to relive every day, that I'm still in the grasp of this. Like my brother said, Pennsylvania has the most prisons in the United States. The most, they're building prisons every day for us. For us people.
Interesting.
You know, I mean, only we can break that bondage
right.
Doing something different.
Exactly.
You know, we got to speak up, talk to one another, love one another. You know, if I don't tell my brother I love him today, you know what I'm saying, he might not be here tomorrow. You know, I mean, hey, funeral piles is a big business right now. You know, I thank God every day that I'm not under the ground right now.
Glad to have you.
You know?
Yes, sir.
That's all I got to say. Thank you.
Brother John Fuller.
Good evening, everyone. For those who speak Spanish, como esta? Internationally, if you're Jewish, shalom. If you're Chinese, buchachi. And if you're from the streets just tuning in for the first time, what's up? Right? So my name is John Doc Fuller. I'm originally from Central New Jersey. Grew up in a dysfunctional, however, two-parent household. My father was an alcoholic. My mother suffered from schizophrenia, which ran in my family. So before I start, I'd like to offer an apology from my generation to the younger generation. And for any of the youth here who are 33, 34, and under, my generation had a profound impact on your generation, and I'll explain that in a minute. The generation and men sitting in the audience who are 65 and older, they rarely considered putting drugs into the hands of our youth. My generation did the opposite. The women from my generation did things which were appalling morally, economically, spiritually. And when my generation failed your generation, we left you fatherless. We were dead, some addicted to drugs or in jail, which left one heck of a burden on the women in our communities. It was a situation where our communities became destitute. And young women, it is not uncustomary for those who are 32 and under to call their mom or grandmother mom. And it's something that is systematic, and it's something that I'm proud to have the privilege of sitting here. And as former inmates, we feel like Vietnam veterans who run into one another every couple of years. We know the struggle that we've been through. We understand the dynamics of change. And so I'm not here to give a motivational speech, I'm more about transformation and the importance of transformation. And perhaps some of the youth, by the time we're done, will get a better understanding of what it takes. Personally, I have three felonies in three different states. I hustled in Arizona, I hustled in Los Angeles, I hustled in Huntsville, Alabama, I hustled in New York, I hustled in Virginia, I hustled in Cincinnati, I hustled in Kentucky, right? And it's nothing to be proud of, but the dynamics are all the same. I come from a small town, and in the town that I grew up in, it was a multicultural town. So white police officers, black police officers, they would get out of the car, throw football with us, the whole nine yards. And so I don't know how I graduated high school to this day. I didn't know how bad I was until the feds locked me up and I was sentenced to 10 years in prison. When the feds did a background investigation, they did everything, including pulling my high school transcripts up. And at that time, I found out that I was number 108 out of 138 that graduated in my class. And I recently looked at my report cards from the time I was in fifth grade all the way up to a senior in high school. And by today's standards, I could not pass the GED. I had D minus. I should have filed a lawsuit against the school. There's no way I should have graduated. But somehow, college was easier than high school. And maybe it was because of the way that teachers taught or the professors taught. So I became a walk-on. I played basketball for 1 year at Middlesex County College. And my world was shook at my first instance of police brutality. I was with a couple of guys by Rutgers University. One of my buddies got into the fight, and police officers came, and they beat us something fierce. They beat us something fierce. And when they were done beating us on the street, they put us in the back of a police car, and they said, let's get these N-words down at the creek. And they put four of us in the back of a police car. And 3 minutes later, all you could hear was the bushes alongside of the police car. And we just knew it was over. Then they hear the police officers say, let's get them at the station. Let's get them at the police. So they backed the car out, got us at the police station, smashed our heads against the wall, tried to put a gun in my buddy's hand to give them a reason to shoot. Now, I didn't know anything about Joanne Chesimard at the time, or Asada Shakur. And this was the same police department out of New Brunswick that was doing this to me and my friends. Somehow we survived, but I took a life of crime after that. I began hustling counterfeit money, drugs, forgery, anything you could name, I was into it. To fast forward to my time in prison, I made it rough. I behaved my way out of prisons, where they did not even want me in prisons. I worked my way from a low to a medium. And in a low security prison in the federal system, you can have from 1 to 20 years. Once you go to a medium, you could have from, I don't know, 5 to 150 years. And then it's the penitentiary from there. So I behaved my way to Virginia, Petersburg, Virginia. From there, I made it to Lewisburg, Pennsylvania, and then to Atlanta Penitentiary. In Atlanta Penitentiary, I learned to speak a little Spanish because I was in the hole with someone from Cuba who had been in the hole for 10 years, and he had come over on the Mario boat lift. And that's when Fidel Castro had released all his prisoners and sent them to Miami. And so I was around hardcore criminals and shipped to Kentucky, Oklahoma, Loretto, Pennsylvania. And it got to a point where I had to really reflect and start doing meditation on my behaviors. What could I do to change my circumstances? And so I was very fortunate to get in contact with a few scholars and like Dr. David Dorsey, who was at Clark Atlanta University, and I'm not sure how familiar you guys are with Dr. Naeem Akbar, who's a clinical psychologist out of Florida. And it was the importance of transformation. And to the young ones, I'll say that that transformation is something that you cannot fake. And the analogy that he gives is that of a caterpillar, which comes into the world as a hairy, disgusting, slimy insect, which is vulnerable to birds, the feet of people who walk by. They're vulnerable to other insects. And when you look at us as human beings, we either enter the world as males or females, helpless, vulnerable, wanting nothing but milk from our mothers, security and protection, right? And so as you transform from a boy, from a male or female to a boy, what are you feeding on? A caterpillar eats on the finest of vegetation, the finest of leaves, knowing that his destiny will one day become a butterfly. But what as individuals are we feeding on? Is it social media? Is it live reality television, which does nothing to stunt your growth, nothing to enhance your growth as an individual?
Exactly.
Is it basketball wives, hip-hop Atlanta? Nothing that stimulates you intellectually, so morally, to become a better man or woman. And the difference between a caterpillar and a human being is that if a caterpillar does not eat, it will die. A slimy, hairy, disgusting creature. But a man can pretend to be a man, but he's still a boy. So he plays boyish games. He gets an apartment. He pretends he's on his own and he's a spiritual man. He pretends like he's a hardworking man, but he's unable to commit to a woman because that's part of being a boy. There's no commitment. When things get rough and there's no spirituality in your house, the relationship is over. I'll just go through the trap door and break up the relationship. And that's the way society is gearing everything. And you notice how in today's culture, when it was crack, it was considered something devastating in the communities. We wanted to be like that. But now it's an opioid crisis, and African Americans really aren't the consumers of all of the opioids, right? So what do they call it now? Oh, it's a health crisis, right? You notice how they play with the little words when it affects certain cultures? So as individuals, one of the most important things we could ever do, and these brothers up here have said it, listening to your conscience or your inner voice. What is that inner voice? Let's talk about it for 3 minutes before we open up for questions. Raise your hand if you know what your mother or your father looks like, just by a show of hands. Even if they died 50 years ago, by a show of hands, raise your hand if you know what your mother or father looks like. One more question. Raise your hand if you know you can say, I love you, and they said, I love you back, if you can remember what that voice is from your mother or father or person who raised you. How is it that you can hear and no sound has been transmitted? Sound travels through vibration between 700 and over 1,000 miles an hour, depending on whether you're at sea level or underwater. But your mouth did not move. Your eyes can see your mother. They can see your father. Whenever your neighbor, and I'll put to this generation here, thank you, I love you for doing the right thing for all of us here, because we did not carry on the tradition, so thank you, women. Thank you. How is it that we can see our past? If we got in trouble and our mother said, wait till your father comes home, we imagined what would happen.
That's right.
It's funny. We knew what our father would say, and we could picture him doing it. These eyes can see the past. These eyes can't see the future. Yet you can see your past and see your future. We live in what's called 3D. Back, forth, up, down, right, left. Right? That's our physical reality. Plus time. Time enables us to move. That's how we get through our day. But we were never taught about in and out. In and out. That voice. That voice, when you know you're doing something wrong, if your pastor, your grandmother, your brother, your father, your uncle told you, don't do that, you're gonna get in trouble. When we ignore that voice, we become susceptible to prison, police beatings, getting set up by the police. And unfortunately, when you're young, you ignore that voice. And when someone older asks you what to do or tell you what you should do, you rather be killed by a kiss than saved by some counsel.
Well said. Well said. Well said.
I was released from prison in 2002. And I didn't have a lot of problems finding a job. I've been employed since then, but I wanted to change the dynamics and hopefully create an avenue for other men when they came home. And one day, one of my clients at the gym told me that his nephew was going to prison in several weeks, and his brother would like to talk to me, so I went over there and they had a lot of questions about what prison would be like. Now, if you're African-American, it's almost a rites of passage, unfortunately, because your uncles, brother, friends in the neighborhood have all gone to prison, so we kind of know what to expect. But for maybe the Italians and wealthy Jewish people, they have no idea. So I started an industry actually called Prison Consulting, where I prepare high-profile clients for prison. I teach them what it will be like. And 2 years ago, I started training criminal defense attorneys who have clients that are going to prison for the very first time. Now, I work alone, but it's something that anyone with prison experience can do. I've been featured on CNN, Entertainment Tonight, Hollywood Access, Fox News. And the sky is the limit. It's just a matter of listening to that inner voice, continuing to transform yourselves as we all have the ability to do. With that, thank you so much for allowing us men here an opportunity to speak and get to know us a little better. And we absolutely do love you. And from the bottom of our hearts, hope that you continue to cherish your freedom and not take the steps that we took, because it's not a hard one. It's not an easy step to take once you've stepped into that realm of prison and enter back into society.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, I noticed some of the statements that you brothers made, that you came from out of some good homes, good parenting and everything. And the reason why I mentioned that, because it debunks. Haven't you heard for years the reason why the prisons are so full? Because they didn't have no good parenting. That is not true in all cases. And as some of the brothers mentioned, they had good parents, but they chose not to listen, to be hard-headed, to be rebellious. And then you had some that they received bad influence from their parents. Can you imagine such? Brother Maurice, what is it that attracted you to the drug world?
Like you said, it was like a rite of passage. It was normal. Like, okay. Everyone...
Was you pressured by any peers or anything?
That's normal. From back, like when I went to prison in 1995, you know, it's kind of cliche is that you're a product of your environment.
Right.
And, you know, you kind of, you know, some people would say, well, one thing about a kid, they can't, well, they don't have the ability to extricate themselves.
And you was 13 at the time, if I'm not mistaken,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Wow.
And
okay.
As an adult, you can move as you want.
Yes.
As a kid, you can't move unless your parents, mm-hmm. you're like, you know, so even if you had the mindset that I want better, there's nothing you can do. You have to suffer mm-hmm. until you reach an age where you can make your own decisions. Because mm-hmm. even if you reach the age of 16, 17, which I didn't on the street, I was reached all of them years in prison, I had no clue. I thought smoking weed, doing codeine was normal.
Right.
And as the older people in our neighborhood, they used to always say, well, you're young, you take the gun, because if you get caught, you get less time.
Mm-hmm.
Far from the truth.
I hope y'all got that. Repeat that again.
Yeah, like the older people in the neighborhoods, you know, that they knew if they got caught, they would do adult time.
Right.
The juveniles, they looked at it as if you would go to a juvenile system or you would just get a slap on the wrist.
Mm-hmm.
I wound up getting a life sentence in prison.
Let me ask you a question. Let me interject just a minute. In your experience, have you noticed the difference in sentencing in the system versus the sentence that is given people of color versus other ethnic groups that may do the exact same crime?
Yeah, we had a guy, Jordan Brown. He committed two murders. Killed his father's wife and killed the newborn baby that was inside the mother.
Mm-hmm.
He's in college right now in Ohio. And he done 7 years.
Wow.
And it went through the court system, and I followed that case for years. And only thing they did was ban him from Pennsylvania, was going back to the region where he committed his crime. And I think that because, you know, like a lot of people always speak about the Clinton administration as if, you know, they was the best for people that look like me. Where was their crime bill in 1994 that put people like me in prison at my age because they deemed us to be super predators? This was the terminology that they used for my generation, that
right.
There's a generation coming up in the 80s and 90s from that crack era.
And that was that generation when Bill Clinton, they put out that law, correct?
Right.
Okay.
And that crime bill played a part in sentencing people 12, 13 years old to prison. And it wasn't until Hillary Clinton ran for president mm-hmm. where she apologized and said, I'm sorry for calling them super predators.
Right.
Because it never came to fruition completely. But it was some truth to what she was saying. It's just how she said it and deemed certain classes right. of people to mm-hmm. be these evil people who come from evil backgrounds that needed to be placed in prison for the rest of their life.
Mm-hmm.
And when you come from, you know, what I call a broken family, where, like I said, like my mother passed away when I was 9.
Right.
Never got a chance to know her.
Uh-huh.
Father, he could be sitting right next to me. Wouldn't even know him.
Wow.
So, who raising you?
Streets will raise you.
This is why, you know, I understand the importance of both parents.
Yes.
And I understand the importance of being grateful to both parents.
Mm-hmm.
Because you miss what you never had. I mean, you heard, you know, people talk like I had both parents. I had a mother, I had a father.
Right.
Because most, they would tell you what's right and what's wrong. You got something like he said, they would help you commit the crime itself.
Mm-hmm.
And in my case, going to prison at that age, like he mentioned the hole, I've done 4 straight years in the hole. 4 straight. And
how old were you when you was put first place in the hole?
When I was first placed, I was 14. I was 14.
And those 4 years were straight through?
I did it a few times. Like, I've done 2 years, done like a year, then I had done 4 straight years.
Describe to us, what do you experience psychologically? What does it do to you mentally and emotionally, being in the hole?
When I came out the hole, actually, I met him.
Okay.
He was refereeing games. I liked it to work out and stuff like that. And when you're inside of a hole, you know, like in the older jails, like these guys, you know, when they went to prison, some of the prisons that I went to wasn't even built yet. So you would suffer sleep deprivation. Because when you sit in a hole for years, and it's unfortunate, you start to act like an animal. I never reached that point where you got guys that would literally throw feces at you. If they seen you walking out in the yard and, you know, they do things that you look like, that's not human, you know? You get a lack of sunlight. Then when you come out, your eyes got to adapt to sunlight again.
Mm-hmm.
You go in a hole, you may come out 50 pounds lighter. You have guards that don't like you. They were spitting your food and show it to you. And what are you going to do, you know? There's times where, you know, like I was telling him, you know, I have things on my back right now that I can show you where I was beat so bad I couldn't walk for a week, you know?
And this was done by guards?
Done by guards. It's called the N-word, constantly being kicked. And to this day, I still have to go through physical therapy for them beating. So, and when you're going into a system where predominantly the people that oversee you is not your color.
Mm-hmm.
I met a guard one time, he said he never saw a black person until he worked in a prison.
Wow.
So the job is to never get there, to experience that in the first place.
Right.
Because once you're there, you become a product of that. And some, and you know, there's some guys that, one of his friends, Dave Henry. I never wish prison on no one, but I think he's probably one of the most dangerous people in the state of Pennsylvania. That's, and I had met him in the REHU, which they call the restricted housing unit, which we call a hole. And he has a lot of good to him. But he's been in a hole since 1999. 20 straight years he's been in a hole.
Wow.
And he's been in there so long.
When they feed you in the hole, is it on the same level as if when everyone come together in the open environment?
No, and that's done intentionally as a preventative to keep you from going
to the
hole.
So basically, what are they giving you to eat?
They may give you the same thing, or they may put you on a restriction, which was called a food loaf.
Food loaf?
Where they put, like the guy that spoke about Dave here, and they gave him a food loaf that had maggots in it.
And they do this, and they do this deliberate and know it?
Intentionally. You know, and I'm not going to say it happens all the time, but it happens.
Yeah.
And there's no oversight. Who's overseeing the prison? Because when you're in prison, most people, there's a reason, I'm not going to say there's a reason, but one of the reasons when you get there is because you had issues in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone constantly told you to do this and do this and do that, they put their hands up and say, you know what, you're on your own. So when you get there, who you calling to say I had maggots in my food? Who you calling to say I got beat so severely I couldn't walk for a week?
Mm-hmm.
Who you calling to inform someone that there's a guy that's my neighbor in a hole, they haven't fed him for 2 weeks? I've seen it happen to a guy, they didn't feed him for 2 straight weeks because he assaulted a guard. But what they won't say, what the guard did to him first.
Right.
They make it just look like he's just a savage. Lock him down. And if you put your hands on a guard, you're not eating, period. You're not eating. So being in that environment, like being in that hole, You can become broken. You can really not like being around people. Like literally, like you know how they say they happy, like I'm a very paranoid person.
Mm-hmm.
I look and turn a lot. Like when I came in and the guy patted me down, almost passed out. Cause it's not like I'm not, you know, I don't want to get used to that again.
Right, right.
Every time I got a walkie.
You know, and when you mention that, it gives you an idea what society have become. Because normally you can go into church,
right?
You would never have
and
to get pat down.
Absolutely.
But now
absolutely.
Things have gotten so bad until you got to pat people down in church. You got to have a metal detector in church. You never had to have that in church.
Absolutely.
You never even had to had a metal detector in school, for goodness sake. But the way society have become, the anger, the hatred, the evil towards each other. It's and I commend you, brothers. If you're able to reach one, I commend you, brothers. I want to hold that thought. And I want to ask Brother Salam the same question. I don't know whether you've ever been in a hole or not, but you did 36 years, correct?
Yes.
Was you ever placed in a hole?
Yes.
Psychologically and emotionally, what did it do to you?
Well, it's a lonely place. And I mean, I did a lot of soul searching in the hole because I was around some stronger people
mm-hmm.
that was giving me inspiration words, because when you place in the hole, you isolated.
How old was you when you first went?
When I first went to the hole, I was like 17.
Wow. How long were you there?
I was in the hole for the first time for 5 months.
Uh-huh.
5 months I was in the hole. And during them 5 months, you know, I was, like I said, I was around some strong people who kind of, you know, kept my spirits up. Because you become lonely and you hear people being beat. You hear people not getting their trays. You hear people on medication. You know, and it comes psychologically, it'll wear off on you if you're not careful enough.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not mindful enough, it'll wear off on you. Before you know it, you might start acting like that same person.
Hold that thought. Brother Sharif, same question. You ever was placed in the hole?
Several times.
And again, you did 36 years.
Yes.
Psychologically, emotionally, describe.
Well, again, being in there, not knowing, I will share this all the time. I couldn't read or write.
Mm-hmm.
So being in the hole, you hear individuals talking and everything. And I tried to write a letter. And when I hollered out the door, this is when I knew I had strong men around me. This is when I knew, I said, man, how you spell that? Somebody spell it for me.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next one, how you spell it?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody spell it to me. So, you know, I was going through that for days and days and days.
And how old were you when you was placed there?
18.
Wow.
You know, and like Camp Hill, it's even rougher now, but when we went through Camp Hill in the 80s, 83, you know what I mean? When you disrespect a guard, I told the guard I was going to knock him out. He was like, yeah, how you going to do it? So I showed him. Boop, boop, pop, bam. He's like, all right. 5 minutes later, they come to the cell. All of them was almost, I thought they was taller than this building. White, ready. Me and guy ain't with Sully's. Step out, Mr. Heyman. Cuff me. First thing he did was smash my head to the wall. And they called the whole Mohawk. Kicked me right in there. They put me in a place where there was nothing but one, no windows and nothing. So nighttime in the mountains, it was cold. And
no windows, so no just window. Dark 24/7.
Well, you got the little light, but the windows up there like that, they was all broken out. So that little sheet that they gave me, you know, and the bugs that was in there, so it was like, it was very ugly. And again, you know, a few days they didn't feed me. But when the smoke cleared, you know, I went through them a few more times, but, you know, strength, you know, we grow immune to a lot of things, and we had to. He spoke about an individual, Dave Henry. He seen him on a different side than I did. Because I was in population with this man, and he was a real, real good man.
Mm-hmm.
But what triggered him to turn to the other side, only God knows, but all I know is the good, you know?
Right.
And
what
he going through now, that's just 120. We had Danny Dunkel, he went in the hole in 1970. I don't know where he at now, but I know he's still in prison. JoJo Barnes, he got every bit of 40 years in the hole. As we speak today.
40 years?
As we speak today, these individuals are still in the hole. So you know, what kind of mentality they got, you know, they'll smile at you, but you don't really know what it is. Danny Dunkel was a white guy, and this is the first guy I ever seen prepare feces.
You say he prepared feces?
To throw on somebody.
Just throw on somebody. What is the worst case that any of you have ever witnessed seeing prison inmates when they come out the hole? What was the worst case that any of you would remember?
Well, I got one up Huntington. A guy got out the hole. A guard, him and the guard went through something. As soon as he got out that hole, he called his family, loved them. The next day he went down the hole, went down the gym, and got a curl bar and took it to that guard, man. And that's why, you know, like, well, y'all ain't been there, but all weights and stuff, they still got weights in there, they stuck, they put
Welded together,
yeah, but he whooped the guard something nice, you know.
Wow.
But again, when you speak about Huntington in the early, I can't speak about the 70s, I know it was worse, but in the 80s when we got there, we were still the N-word. As soon as we got off the bus from Grade 4, y'all ain't Grade 4 no more. You know, I mean, right from the door, they put us in a, a ugly situation.
Brother Garland, you ever spend time in a hole? Psychologically, emotionally? What would you say the effects was?
To me, it was like...
Speaking your microphone, brother.
Sorry. To me, it was like anything else. You get used to it. You know what I mean?
So
like,
you allowed yourself to adapt.
Yeah. I mean, you had no other choice.
Okay.
You know, you wait for your little mail, write letters like the brother said.
How long was you in for?
I did 7 months in a hole.
Wow. Okay.
But like they said, I mean, it was rough, but you get used to it. You adapt. You adapt. You got to. You know what I mean?
All right. Brother Jamal.
Yes, sir.
What about yourself?
4 months in a hole. Like you said, he had to adapt. You know, you get used to living a certain way while you're in prison. Then when you go to the hole, all that's stripped from you. You know, they try to break you down and strip your dignity.
You didn't feel like you were, like, mentally or emotionally just it done something to you?
I was getting to that point because I was used to talking to some of the brothers and whatnot. And the whole, you got to yell or send a kite to your next neighbor or whatever. You
know
what I mean? So you had to really change yourself.
Brother Fuller, what about yourself?
Yes, I behaved my way into holes all over the country. they with certain people who they may deem a political prisoner or someone who they can't control.
Okay.
They did what they call diesel therapy. So I didn't even know what state I was in sometimes unless cars were driving by and I would look at the license plates. Oh, I'm in North Carolina. Oh, I'm in Oklahoma. Oh, I'm in Georgia. You know, so I didn't know where I was going. So they would throw me in the hole. I'd be there for 3-4 months. And it was a lonely feeling. And it was weird because you look up and there may be a window and you just want to see a bird fly by because you haven't seen a bird in so long. Okay. And so you're just looking for anything from nature, an airplane to fly over, because all you have is a small window, maybe 6 inches.
Mm-hmm.
And when they put you in the hole, they have very powerful toilets because a lot of guys who go to the hole, they'll flood the floors if they're not giving them their food, allow them to shower, recreation. So the strength of the toilets are designed to suck a t-shirt down. You can suck a towel down.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, I never wanted them to think that the hole was given the upper hand on me.
Okay.
So I would work out physically, but then I would wash my clothes in the toilet. And as the fresh water was coming down, I would hold on to my shirt very, very hard and scrub it with the soap and then hang them on my bed. And they would say, Fuller, you want wreck? Nah, you can't do nothing for me. Then they would ship me to another prison and another one. So psychologically, it was devastating, but I did not allow them to know how I was feeling.
In reference to drugs, which one of you was in the drug game the longest? When I mean the drug game, distribution, selling, making money, getting others to sell for you. You, brother? Define,
absolutely.
Describe.
It's something that's built on trust.
Okay.
You work your way up. And I got to a point where they were finding old, discreet vans, and they would soda weld the gas tank and put in a false gas tank under the bottom and put kilos in and then re-weld them, and I would drive keys into Utah from
so
LA.
You was what they called a mule.
Yes, I was a mule with plenty of keys.
What was the narcotics that you was handling?
Heroin and cocaine.
Okay.
Yes, and then I made arrangements because I have friends from LA that were originally from Pittsburgh, so I had a crew of guys that were from Germany. Because they were Caucasian, I knew that they wouldn't get pulled over the way the average African-American would. And so they were driving keys and vans across the United States from Los Angeles, because in LA, a Kia Coke was going for $13,500. In Pittsburgh, they were going for $39,000.
Okay, let me ask you a question. And I want to ask this a question because it's very important, because as you know today, television and social media they present drug deals going down and things like that. Are there similarities to reality, or is it a vast difference from reality? And the reason why I ask that, because what I find is luring what's a lot of young people into the drug game is because of what is shown on television, and it gives them, the younger generation, this great appeal. Besides deterring them from it, it generates the curiosity and draws them to it. So to the young brothers and sisters, would you say it has a lot of similarities, or what Hollywood produced is sheer hypocrisy compared to reality?
It's pure hypocrisy, because Hollywood shows only the success. They show the White House and the picket fence. They don't show the drug deals going bad. I know guys who the whole families were murdered because they came up short with money. And
what way was they killed?
Oh, execution style. You know, guys, drug deal going bad. I know guys that left Los Angeles, flew into Missouri, into St. Louis, killing families, flying into Detroit, killing families.
Can you define the method of murder, the method of killing? Shot in the head, hacked up with an axe?
Mostly shot in the head. Mm-hmm. A lot of the old style executions were really taking place in Miami, because mm-hmm. during the Mario Boatlift, once these guys came over, they were already hardened criminals in Cuba. Mm-hmm. So coming to the United States, getting paid $10,000-$15,000 to kill somebody, that's rich in Cuba, mm-hmm. you know? And so the effects are still there. I had the privilege of going to Cuba this past September and speaking to some of the people in Havana and Myanmar. They remember their family members coming over here to the United States, getting involved in some of these murders, knowing that their family members are still incarcerated 30, 40 years later, but these were some of the heinous murders that were taking place. And it's all in the lore. It comes from the music. You know, I got friends, and we
very
all
well
know people
said.
Who can sing, but the record producers, they don't want that music. They want violence. They want you to degrade women, have no respect for your elders. Mm-hmm. That's what's selling.
What is the difference? And I want each of you brothers to give your input. What is the difference that you see in the young people today versus your generation? What is the difference, Brother Salim?
Well, the difference I see with young people today opposed to when I was growing up, they really have no regards for human life. And I understand why, because they mentor and who they raised by are different people that, you know, it was a saying where I work in a school. It was a saying by Malcolm X. He said, we have to start looking at each other in a set of different eyes, because the value of human life means nothing.
True.
But in my time, it was no problem with me seeing a lady cross the street. Good morning, Miss So-and-so, how you doing? Mm-hmm. You need me help you cross the street? But in these days and time, you don't see that.
True.
You don't see that.
Okay.
And the respect value is at all time low.
Yes.
You know, I ride the SEPTA bus. You don't really see people getting up and give older people their seats no more.
Exactly.
You know, I couldn't dare do that. My mother would beat the mess out of me. Mm-hmm. Even though I never got on the bus at that age, just to hear that I would have did something like that, my mother would have, you know, just said something to me. Even though I had three older brothers, but my mother would have told me, okay, wait till Greg get home. You know, which is one of my oldest brothers' mm-hmm. name. Wait till Greg get home. And that was enough for me. But it's just the value of respect have gone. You know,
right.
We don't have no value in human life no more.
Brother Maurice, what do you see?
It's kind of the same. Like, I recently had a conversation with my sister's father, and he's 70 years old now. And he said that nowadays the teachers are scared of the kids. Mm-hmm. The parents are scared of the kids.
Mm-hmm.
The superintendents of the schools are scared of the politicians.
Mm-hmm.
And the politicians are scared of voters. And the kids ain't scared of nobody. And when he said it, I'm like, makes sense.
Yes, sir.
Because I know when I was young, I remember I called my fourth grade teacher by her first name, which was Rosemary. And she literally choked me so bad that, like, she literally got up from her desk, ran over, and literally just choked me so bad to where as though almost like fainted.
Mm-hmm.
And that's by me calling her by her first name, which was a no-no.
Yes.
When you was, you know, and that was, I was in fourth grade, however what I was. I think I was 9, 10, like, whatever it is. And she had the permission from my grandmother to choke me.
Wow.
Nowadays, kids get to go to school and tell on their parents. Mm-hmm. One of my friend's brother was just arrested because he hit his son, because his son hit his daughter. And his father now has a criminal background. So you can't even raise your own kids anymore the way you want, that you see fit.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you can't raise them, but the school get to raise them, but when they do wrong, you gotta pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the biggest difference now is also like the video games.
Yes.
Where kids literally all day long sit and play Fortnite.
Exactly.
You know, I keep hearing about this game so much, it's almost like it's a drug. And you can't get them off of it. But they playing from literally 12 hours, even on school nights. So I couldn't dare be in my grandmother's house, even waking up at 5 o'clock, let alone playing a game at 5 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the biggest difference now, where the teachers, they're handicapped. You know, and for me, the only like disciplinary that I had would have been my uncle. And my uncle, you know, I still have actually I was texting him last night and that I told him that I may be coming here or whatever. And he said, don't tell none of my stories, you know? Cause he could easily be in jail, you know? From some of the stuff he did to me when I was young, you know? But now that I look back on it, I wish he had done it more. It was coming from a love standpoint because their generation was taught love. Like the elders that's here, it's a total different generation.
Very much so.
Total different generation. So my generation, we wasn't taught love. You can't get what you ain't got. And I think that's why some of us done some of the things that we done.
Right.
Their generation, they had to be best friends.
Yeah.
Like my grandmother were married for 60 years. We can't be friends for 10 minutes, you know? So I think the generational gap is a very serious thing because the kids of today that we get a chance to speak to, they have no problem with pulling the gun on you.
True.
You know? You wouldn't dare, you wouldn't even cuss around your grandmother.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't even come close to even saying anything close to her being this close, because as soon as you say it, this will come next.
Oh, yes.
You know? So I think the respect factor that he spoke about by being on an L, being on a trolley, getting up out of a seat so your elder can sit down, helping the elder shovel the snow. Like, I like doing stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
I'll shovel the whole block for free
because
I wish I got a chance to do it when I was young. So I'm making up or trying to make up for what I should have been doing then
and
I try to do now. So try getting the kid now to go shovel some snow without giving him a game or giving him, and them games are expensive. They're like $70.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I never saw $70 as a teenager, you know? So, but it takes, you know, unfortunately, sometimes it takes someone to tell a story. To say, like I was, had mentioned the kid that I spoke to Friday in Southwest Philadelphia at Mr. Jenner's office. I asked him, I said, do you love your grandmother? His grandmother had brought him in. He said, yeah. So I asked his grandmother, what is the best thing that he do for you at the house? She said, destroy it. Punch holes in her wall and all that. So he said, well, I do sweep the neighbors. I said, you got to start with the house.
Right.
Your grandmother bought them clothes. Your grandmother feeds you. Be nice to the neighbor, but don't clean their stuff first without cleaning your grandmother's stuff first.
Right.
You know? And I think that sometimes kids think it's okay to destroy within and be nice on the outside.
Exactly.
It's kind of like the hypocrisy thing where you clothed, as a sheep, but you're really a wolf inside.
Right.
Because it could be a dangerous thing as their kids get older. Because he takes that into his adult life. Loving what's outside and hating what's inside. Mm-hmm. That which really love you. So that's what I would say, like the generation that he spoke about. Like how he said, I apologize on behalf of my generation.
Yes, sir. Good. All right, before I get Brother Sharif, I want some brothers to get some microphones on this side. Quickly, please, because we're on the clock and I only have a few more minutes. I wanted some brothers to get some microphones on this side. All right, well, I tell you what, let me borrow two microphones. Come on, brother, one of your brothers get one of these quickly, please. It doesn't matter which one. If one of your brothers get one. And stay on that side, you stay on that side. Now, I'm going to get Brother Sharif, and I'm going to get my other brother, in reference to the same question that I asked. But you that are young people who want to ask them questions, stand now. I'm going to try to get as many as I can. Any young people want to ask them questions, stand on your feet now. So they would know, even if they're not young, anybody who want to ask them questions, stand on your feet now, please, and remain standing. Standing on your feet and remain standing. Because you young folk, you ought to have questions. And plenty of them. All right, Brother Sharif, same question.
When I went to jail, we had black-owned things.
We had what now?
Black-owned businesses.
Black-owned businesses, right. Okay, right.
When I came home 36 years later, it's nothing there. You know what I mean? We had mentors out there trying to put us in the right direction. It was nothing there, you know? And it's so sad to see that. And again, the love factor, because for some reason, as black folk, we don't love each other.
Mm-hmm.
We don't love each other. We don't appreciate each other. You know what I mean? We're like crabs in a barrel. When we look at Philadelphia right now, everything foreign is running our city.
Mm-hmm.
Everything foreign. And it's an ugly sight. And you ask yourself, why? Because we don't appreciate each other.
Well,
we are
said.
Angry at each other.
True.
And when you speak about the youth don't respect they self.
True.
So what give you, what think you gonna respect a man or a woman? When we seen the ladies when we was kids, you know, when we was drinking and everything, look at Miss Mary.
Right.
We put the
you hid you looking
you
back at
hey,
you.
Miss Mary, how you doing?
Yeah.
And you help with the groceries and all that.
Right.
When I walk, me and my brother walk around sometimes, say, Miss, can we help you with that? They say no.
Exactly.
Because they're not used,
to
the
that
kindness
now.
Coming from mm-hmm. the men that's concerned today.
You know, that's something to say, that when you offer help today to an elderly woman, she get paranoid because she's literally not used to someone being kind to her. That's a very powerful statement when you think of it.
It definitely is.
Go ahead, brother.
Well, I'm done, but I just say, if we can love each other, look at this. Just look at it. If mm-hmm. we can unite and stop being crabs in the barrel of one another, we are powerful than we can ever be.
Same question, Brother Fuller. Yes.
I honestly think that the youth are hurting, and a lot of what they do is a cry for help. I think that, you know, there are very subtle ways that they want to ask questions. There are very subtle means that they have, which is different from our generation, mm-hmm. where they try to be heard.
Okay.
And unfortunately, because of time and the busy schedules that some of the older people have, they don't have the time that we had 30 years ago. And so because of that, you find them doing everything, whether it's the our poor sisters posing nearly nude on Instagram to get likes, our brothers holding up money and alcohol just to get likes, doing things on Facebook just to get likes. And you know, if you poll that generation, it's very, most of the young boys and the young women were molested during that period of time when the fathers were in jail or prison or dead. You know, the boys as well as the women, and these boys are hurting. These young sisters are hurting
yes.
because our generation let them down. And everything they do, 9 out of 10 times, it's a cry for help.
Well said, Brother Garland.
Me, myself, I think the youth today, when I was growing up, I got whoopings. You know what I mean? I got punishment. I got punishments, whippings with belts, stenching cords, whatever. My dad was fine. And for real, even in school, when you didn't wear your gym shorts, you got a paddle from the gym teacher, you know? And really, I think when you stop disciplining at home, that's what it's at now, you know? These ladies here, I'm sure they spanked their kids. When you punish your kid was a better kid. And to me, I think, you know, now, like I said, there's no more, the kids tell you, if you hit me, I'm gonna call DHS on you, you know what I mean?
Right.
So that's where they run wild of me.
Well said.
So that's what I see.
Brother Jamal.
It's a big difference right now. Like, I guess the younger generation need to respect the older, and the older need to start listening to the younger ones. You know, because I remember that time, it was my neighbor who used to be able to whoop me and didn't tell my parents when they came home and they whooped me.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, like, we need to start sticking together, like, stop closing in, and you know what I'm saying? We need to speak up towards one another. You know?
Well said. All right, we're going to get our side of sisters first. So where are the brothers that got the microphone, please? All right, hold it right there, brother. Hold it right there. My sister, start from the back. Whoever's the furthest one, the sisters that are standing, whoever are standing, and let them ask their question.
Hello, I'm an attorney in South Jersey, and I want to know what you have to say about the defense that you had or lack thereof, and just defense counsel in general.
Were you speaking to me, or who were you speaking to, sis?
Any of you.
And when you said defense,
what do you have to say about any defense representation that you had for your counsel, defense attorneys, or what do you have to say in general about the attorneys and how they represent our community?
I think that, unfortunately, most attorneys in the Philadelphia region, their first objective is to get you to plead guilty. Their goal is not to go inside because it costs money. And lawyers are friends of the court. And I think that, you know, there's the statistic that you can easily, that you probably may know about yourself, that 90% of convictions come from plea deals. It's not a challenge to the evidence whether you're right or wrong. There are people that I know in prison right now, me and him speak to this person on a regular basis, that have been in prison since 1987 for something he didn't do. And it's known that he didn't do it, but he's time barred. And anyone who don't know what time bar is, you can be right, but you pass the deadline to prove that you're right.
Wow. Repeat that again.
You can be right.
Yes.
Let's say I have this whole congregation saying that he wasn't there. He was in New Jersey. But because the deadline passed, you get 1 year. 1 year. So let's say I couldn't find a person in a year. I was sitting down in prison because I couldn't find a person in a year. And if that's not an injustice, I don't know what is. You got people that's sitting in prison. One, like me and him speak to this guy on a regular basis. 1987, he's been in prison 32 years plus for something that he didn't do. So what they do in Pennsylvania a lot, they get you to accept the plea deal. Your lawyer will come to you and say, listen, I got a deal for you 10 to 20 years. And you may say, I didn't do it. Yeah, but you know, this is going to be a hard case to fight. And the state, or the city rather, costs a lot of money to defend a person. Attorneys are expensive, you know? And it's easier to just say, you know what, I did it. And in actuality, you didn't do it. So I think in regards to representation, because I was actually offered a plea deal, but I was 13 years old. I couldn't picture 20 years. But they offered me 20 years. No one said, you know what, I wish I would have taken it, because I did my crime. But no one said, this is what you should do. It was the lawyer that said, this is what you should do. Now let's say if I didn't do the crime. His whole thing is, we got enough evidence to show that you did do it. So just plead guilty. So I think from that standpoint, I think that more attorneys should have more oversight in regards to how they treat their clients. Because I had a family member pay $40,000. For an attorney who literally took that money and done nothing. I sat in jail for 10 more years. Where all he had to do was say, that's too hard for me. but who's going to refuse $40,000? You know? So I think the biggest obstacle, at least in Pennsylvania, like I'm not sure how Jersey runs their penal system and their judicial system, but at least in Pennsylvania, when you get to the lower court level, because the deals take place on a lower court, there's no law involved. The law gets when you get to the Superior and the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. That's when they start to deal with law.
Okay.
When you're in the lower court, you'll see a person commit murder and get 2 to 5 years. Won't happen in that Supreme Court because they know it's not legal. It's an illegal sentence. So on a lower level, them judges are elected. The higher levels are appointed. Mm-hmm. They're elected. So you can go out and vote and say, you know what? I don't think you're doing the right job. You know? So the government is for the people, by the people. But why so many of our people suffer from our own people? All of the judges that resentenced us, they were black. You know? These are our own people doing injustice to our own people. Now, like I said, for me, I have no complaints because I actually did my crime. And it's something that I spoke to the family about, you know, time in and time out on how remorseful I am for that crime. But for other people who didn't do their crime, who's languishing in prison system for 30, 40 years, having to admit guilt. There's juvenile, there's people who fell when they were 16, 17 years old, had to go before a judge that we went before, and she made them admit guilt, although they claimed innocence for 30 years. Mm. She said, if you don't admit guilt, I can't resentence you because you're still challenging your innocence. That's wrong. Because you're making me say that I committed a crime that I didn't commit in order for you to free me.
True.
So I think that just for like the judicial system, these are people that's voted in. Either you voting or you're not voting.
Right.
You can't complain if you ain't voting. Mm-hmm. You can't complain about a problem that you can fix. So some of our family members who we know get criminal records, they can't even get good jobs no more because they had to plead guilty to a crime that they didn't even, you know, commit. So I just will hope that lawyers, if there are more lawyers in here, I would love to speak to you on a personal basis. Maybe you'll take a case pro bono, you know, because there are in it, like, you know, how, I believe it was Dr. Martin Luther King, where he said, an injustice anywhere is an injustice everywhere. Mm-hmm. And also, it's better for 99 men to be let go out of prison to convict one innocent man. It's better to let 99 people go who did commit their crime than convict one innocent person who didn't commit their crime. Because a lot of us probably done stuff we didn't get caught for. And there's a guy that I know in prison, he accepts the fact that he's dying in prison, that for something he didn't do, because all the stuff he got away with.
All right, okay.
He says, so now I'm getting my punishment now. Because all the stuff I did do. But for the people who didn't do their crimes, I think it's an injustice when it's known that a piece of paper that you didn't file on time precludes you from ever going home because Bill Clinton, he did that. It's called the Anti-Effective Death Penalty Act, ADEPA. That's the acronym for that, Anti-Effective Death Penalty Act, meaning you got 1 year to prove innocence. And if you can't prove it, you die in jail.
All right. Next question. So is that a standard?
My question is to all of the men. I heard some of you speak about your families and, you know, how that affects you, that some of y'all couldn't attend your family funerals. But how does it, I get, like when you get out, you know, how did you all reconcile yourselves back to your family?
Fortunately, for myself, you know, my family, I was the baby of the bunch, so I had nieces and nephews that's older than me, and we was close knit, and they made effort to come see me. You know, my brothers, my sisters, and when my mother was alive, and my father, they definitely made sure they came. But, you know, and my nieces had babies and stuff. They wanted to make sure I seen them. Mm-hmm. So it was real. I am thankful to say that I had a close-knit family that had my back.
All Any other brothers want to comment on that?
I would agree. I had a very close-knit family also, and it's sad when you have some family members out there who will freeze people in time. You know, they expect you to be the same person you were prior to going into prison, mm-hmm. when they don't understand the transformation that you've made, the acceptance of responsibility. So I wasn't on the other end of my family rejecting me. They had very high hopes for me as a young person, and they did not freeze me in time and hold that against me when I came home.
Okay. Any other brothers?
I would like to say something about, like, most younger people go to jail because they don't have families. You know, shouldn't no 14, 15-year-old kid be sitting in no prison? I don't care what his family looks like. Because for me, these are my family members. You know? Like I said, my mother gone, grandfather gone, grandmother gone, brother murdered, cousin murdered. Like, they're gone. So there's no reconciliation.
Right.
You know, so the people that are left, like I speak to my uncle at times, but at day's end, I was gone so long, now I'm smarter than him now. Mm-hmm. He asks me questions that I should be asking him, you know? But I don't have no hatred towards the ones that are left, because as I said earlier, you can't give what you ain't got. They was never taught love.
Right.
My own brother, I seen him twice in 23 years. Mm. So when I finally seen him a few months ago, he asked me, man, he said, how was it? I said, you tell me. I got a lot to tell you. Do you really want to hear it, though? You know? So I don't even have them conversations.
Right.
Because somebody's going to be mad when they leave that conversation. Mm-hmm. But I'm not bitter towards any of them, though. But there's no reconciliation, though.
All right.
Like, for me, because at day's end, you knew I was a kid when I went in. Mm-hmm. And you left me there. As I said, I done what I done. Very remorseful for what I done. But you still was my family member.
Right.
And you left me there to fend for myself at 13 years old. So right. That's what I got to say.
All right. Next question.
So say you were sick in prison and would you get like the same treatment as if you were in the hospital?
Not at all.
The question was, if you were sick in prison, would you get the same treatment as if, like, if you're not in prison? The young like, fella asked that.
I got personal experience. Like I have Crohn's disease. It's an intestinal disease. Mm-hmm. I had 3 surgeries in the last 10 years for that disease. And the medications that I was on for 13 years, I went to the hospital down at University of Penn. The doctor said, we don't even use that. He said, we don't even use it. He said, the medication you've been on for 13 years, we don't use that particular medication mm-hmm. out here in the community. Mm-hmm. And when I was up a certain prison, I became so sick that I became sepsis and almost died off my own vomit. And it took 23 cells to hold their hands outside their cell slot to get me medical attention. When they passed out trays, everyone stuck their hands out and said, we not shutting this until y'all get them medical help. So I couldn't call 911 to come get me. Mm-hmm. I'm in a hole. I can't do anything. And I swear, I've seen, we just talked about this morning, we've seen people commit suicide, kill themselves, being in them environments. Because wow. You become so sick and you get tired of being in pain, we're out here. Just to be able to go into a doctor's office and say, this is how I'm doing. When you're in prison, they want to see how bad you're doing first. Because they think you're lying. Mm. And I have a pre-existing condition. And they still treating me as if I'm lying. All right. And when you go to the hospital, you get handcuffed to the bed. You're not moving. I was in 4-point restraints. Handcuffed to the hospital bed. Or armed guards next to you. You're not moving nowhere. And if you got to go to the bathroom, they bring you a little pot, put it next to your bed. That's where you go at. So to sit in the hospital, when I went to the hospital, it was like luxury for me to go to a hospital. Although I'm chained to the bed because I know I'm going to get the best treatment. And I know the doctors, they don't have no horse in a race. Street hospital. I like when I got sick,
it was like a privilege to go to a street hospital. Because in prison, unfortunately, I know a lot of people that passed away in prison hospitals. Okay. Because it's not really a hospital, it's still a prison.
Right, right, right.
They just call it a hospital.
Okay.
So you don't get the same treatment, though.
All right. We're going to have to move quick because we're on the clock. Come on, sister.
I got a question about if any one of you all that have children, if your child is hard-headed, how you handle it, handling that child, and also what would make you give that child up? What is it, any circumstance that will make you turn your back on your child?
Not at all. And that's a good question because I don't have no children, but if I did, I would whoop them. You know what I mean? And I would discipline them in every way that I can because, see, right now, this conversation that we're holding deals with everything. And we ignore taking care of our kids. Right now, we're looking at these cell phones. I couldn't spell a minute ago. Now I can spell two, and they just say, you ain't got to spell, all you got to do is put two, you. You know what I mean? You ain't got to spell no more. So I'm going to discipline my child, you know, and go from there.
Go ahead, bro.
My daughter was 3 when I fell to the feds, and she was 15 when I came home. And even though she had come, her expectations were very high when I came back home. And I had to discipline her one time, old school, extension cord. And she went to school, and she had marks on her arm. And so the principal had no choice but to notify the Division of Youth and Family Services. So they came to my house, they left a card because I was at work. Well, when I arrived home, my daughter was already home, and I said, oh, they want us to come down to the Division of Youth and Family Services. I said, let's go, you and I. She said, no, that's for you. I said, no, we're going together. So I go down to the Division of Youth and Family Services, and, you know, they mentioned my prison background because I had been home for 6 months. And so they wanted to know, why did you do this to your daughter? I said, I get up at 4:30 in the morning. I pick my daughter up from school. I buy my daughter the clothes that she wears. When you can do what I do, you come take her and you raise her. And I made sure that my daughter was present when I said what I said. And, you know, my daughter's much older now, mm-hmm. but you know what, like I tell her, the same cage that keeps the bird in keeps the kitty out. Right? And so the things that we do for our children, sometimes they're not meant for our child to understand now. Mm-hmm. It's meant for them to understand years from
exactly.
now. And as long as you're consistently reminding them that you're going to be upset with me, things are good now, but there are times when I'm going to have to be your disciplinarian.
That's right.
It's much more palatable.
Exactly. All right. Come on, sister.
Greetings, brothers. I just got a question as to what was really going on through your mind during your crime. Like, did something spiritually come over you, or just what was your actual mindset?
What was your mindset when you asked them, what was their mindset when they committed whatever crime?
When it happened.
When it happened. What was the mindset
when
it
happened? Well, my mindset, I was high on drugs, so therefore, I was trying to comfort out myself. I didn't want to face reality. You know, I always wanted to escape who I was. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I depended on drugs to have me become a different person, an alter ego. You know, when I was on drugs, I was a better person, so I thought I can talk what I wanted to talk, and people would listen, you know. So, no, I wasn't really in the right state of mind.
Okay. All right. Next question.
We did a debate in my class about the death penalty, and I would like to ask them, what do you guys think about the death penalty?
What do you brothers think about the death penalty?
Well, in Pennsylvania, the death penalty is a joke because they don't kill nobody. So men are sitting, you know, it's friends of ours that's sitting on death row just rotting away because they're not killing them. So when you speak about it, it's an ugly thing, first and foremost, and for them to have the men locked up like that shouldn't exist.
Okay. Next question.
Have any of your friends been killed by police brutality?
Have any of your friends been killed by police brutality?
We had friends killed in jail by guards' brutality. It's not just a street thing. It's also take place in there. So
you know, I know for me personally, on both sides, inside and on this side, where, you know, I've lost friends to, you know, like he said, police brutality, you know, whether it was justified to them, wasn't justified to me and their loved ones, but yes.
All right. Next question. Just a minute, sister. They're passing the microphone. They can't hear you without one. Go ahead.
I went through the same thing. I lost my sister, and she had three children, and I couldn't take care of them. And plus my daughter, I couldn't take care of her, but I got them in a nice home. And like you say, I have seen my brother since my mom and my dad passed away. And my other sister, she passed away too. She had one leg amputated. And how about you? I understand about you, Maurice. And you pray for me and I do the same for you too.
Okay, thank you, sister. Yes, sister, next question. Now, there's one in back of you. They coming. Wait till, when the microphone comes, you know it's you.
Greetings, and thank you for sharing. I want to thank you. Some of you were talking about your conscience and listening to your conscience. And I wanted to know if, like, when you were younger, how much like, God were you exposed to? Like, how much was God present in your life? And how much did you pray before and afterwards, like when you were in jail?
That's a very good question, and I'm big on that, your conscience, right? I didn't understand it when I was out there. You know, I had to tune into it when I was away, and I remember getting in the fights. I remember when I was going, we fighting them all, you know what I mean? And your inner soul told you, when you went to the bathroom or anything that morning, don't go fight that boy. You know what I mean? Don't go fight that boy. And when you go, we're going to do it, and you came back with that busted lip, that bloody nose and everything, but something spoke to you. Something told you to go the other way, and we didn't understand how to be the bigger person then. And being incarcerated, I really tuned into my inner soul.
Oh, go ahead, brother.
Just briefly, I think Dr. Jennings could attest to this, and regardless of whether you studied Freud, Roberson, Skinner, or any other psychologists, I think they would all agree that your frontal part of your brain does not fully develop until you're in your 20s. And so a rational decision by most young people cannot be made. When you see the decisions that these young men made, it was bigger than peer pressure. Their brain had not even developed to accept and make certain responsibilities that would be in or cohesive to their conscience. And if you can't do that, of course you're gonna make mistakes. We can blame it on whatever we wanna blame it on, but the reality is that our brains are not even developed until you're in your 20s.
I just wanna say one thing to that.
Go ahead, brother.
I think that even society recognizes that, and here's why. In everything, at my age, couldn't drink, couldn't smoke legally, couldn't buy a house, couldn't own a car. Even society acknowledges that you have to be at least 18 to do all of these responsible things. It's only in the criminal justice system where they treat a kid like an adult. If I get pulled over driving a car when I'm 15, the parent get in trouble. Whereas an adult, you get in trouble. Even society recognizes that right. We're not the same, you know? And I think that from a conscious standpoint, when you, how he said, like, you know, this is one of the things that led the court to their decision, that the brain science thing. This wasn't about a law. This was about pure brain science. If it was about a law, we'd be still sitting in prison. It was about the brain science that was attested to from different doctors and psychologists and things that said they're not equal in their actions. I couldn't formulate to plan a crime, commit it, and how to get away with it. Everything that we did was just rational. Well, irrational, but you thought it was rational. And it was off of impulse. When you reach an adulthood, now that's when the planning comes in. That's when the cunning comes in. That's when I could wait a year later to do something wrong to you and won't lose sleep about it. Not saying I can, but kids don't do that. A kid can't think past a year. They need it now.
Right.
They need gratification now.
Right.
And I think that's the biggest thing that get lost at time with comparing adults to children. Like, they're not the same.
Exactly. All right, next question, quickly. Yes.
So I have a nephew that went to prison at a very early age for selling drugs.
And he's out now, but he was raped, like consistently raped. So what would your suggestion be to family members that really want to reach out and help him psychologically? He's still caught up in this fact of just being so several times being raped. So what is your suggestion or any suggestions that you might have for me as a family member and as for other family members that want to reach out? What kind of conversation should I have? Is there some place I can take him? So help us out. Tell us what we need to do.
He needs help. He needs deep psychological help, and the entire family has to be supportive of that. Because if he does not receive it, he is bound to inflict it on someone else.
I think that, you know, unfortunately, that's common in prison, and it shouldn't be. And they passed some laws over the past couple of years called the Prison Rape Elimination Act, something like that, where, you know, things have changed some, but that is an environment where people get preyed upon. And I think once you come out of that, you have to let the individual choose the time when they're ready to talk about it. Because sometimes we ask so many questions, and it may be that one thing that they may answer that may cause them to take their life. Because of the embarrassment and the shame that a grown man can physically be subdued, and as you say, took an advantage of, because we don't look at ourselves like that. No one would look at a grown man like myself and say, that can't happen to him. It can. It can happen. And when it does happen, you couldn't imagine four or five guys holding you down. And you can't even imagine someone even agreeing to come together to commit such an act. And when it happens, it's the most degrading, the most humiliating thing that a man can go through, because he always say, I'm a man.
Right.
And we've been conditioned to say your man has been taken. So you have to let the individual be the one to say, I'm ready to talk about this. And as guys like us, we love helping people like that. We'll sit down with them as a group and let them tell the story just like we're telling our story. Because I think we're the best people. And also Dr. Jennings, he's a very smart guy. You know, he's a psychologist, forensic psychologist. So it's not just a help amongst us. But like he said, he needs deep psychological help.
Right.
To let him know, it's not your fault. It's not your fault. Mm-hmm. So, but situations like that, we'd be glad to help you and your family out.
Good. Wonderful. All right, yes, sister.
Yes. What's the procedures for transferring? Like, my brother's in Huntington, PA, and we're here. And we want him transferred, like, into Chester. So what procedures we have to take to get him transferred?
Basically, that's a given. If he a good guy.
He is.
Eventually, he,
not it, good, but
yeah, yeah, but if he a good guy, they'll get around to it. But for the most part,
he is on the list.
Yes, that's, you just got to be patient with that. That's all.
You got to be patient.
And hopefully the jail that you want him to get to, he'll make it there.
He's been there 40 years.
Yeah, wow.
I did. You know what? Your local politicians and your mayor, they have a lot of influence. And I think that as a constituent, that's a reasonable request. You let your politicians know, I'm a constituent, I'm supportive of you, and right now, as your constituent, I am in need of a favor. Explain what your nephew or your son did, and say, by no means am I asking you to release him. However, I would like you to write a letter to the prison to see if he could be designated closer to home, so that as a family, we can be supportive of him during his incarceration and when he comes home. And I guarantee you, they'll respond.
All right, we got a few more minutes. Come on real quick so we can get to the other side.
For those of you who were in the right state of mind when you took someone's life, would you say you were in a state of coldness, like, during the crime? And would you say it was, like, pre-planned, or?
All murder is cold and bad, even when the state do it, and they call it justifiable homicide, you know? The person who's asked about the death penalty. It's still a form of murder. We just become conditioned to accept it when another person commits murder. But to answer your question directly, for me, I was high on drugs. I was high on codeine. It doesn't excuse the act itself, but when you see any person that's in a drunken state of mind, right?
When they wake up the next day and you tell them what they did, they be like, I really did that? They be like, nah. Somebody may say, but you need to stop drinking if you can't remember that. I sat in the police station for 3 days. Didn't even know I committed murder until the second day. And I still didn't believe him. I wanted to see a body. But it goes back to the drug thing, you know? It befogs your mind. It makes you think of things that you would never in your calm or sober mind come to thinking about. And I guarantee you, all of us up here can tell a story about being addicted to drugs while doing a crime. All of us. So you have some people, like especially as you get older, when you're dealing with youth, it's a big difference. Because at my age, I shouldn't have been taking codeine. My body wasn't, it's like, I wasn't mature enough to even process such a strong drug, you know? So at that age, not to excuse the act that I done, nor justify it, but you have to even just look at a person, just on a daily basis, you may walk up, you know, one of these blocks there in North Philly, and you see a person that's in a drunken state. And you look at them and you be like, ah, they don't know what they, you know. Like, you excuse a lot that they do. Murder can never be excused. But for me specifically, at that age, taking them type drugs, and codeine is a very strong drug, especially when you mix it with another drug. So you're not in your right state of mind. And I think that when you get back to talking about the drug issue, if you take that out, a lot of crimes wouldn't be committed. Because the drugs cause you to commit crime for money, for vengeance, for the pleasure of another woman, for the pleasure of your own family to say, well, I done X, Y, and Z because they did this. A lot of them crimes are driven by drugs. And a lot of people don't be in a right state of mind. This is why you'll see a person that drink and drive. Why do they get the less? They get the least amount of time? When they kill someone on the road, it's still a form of murder. Why they get the least amount of time? Because the government has accepted that that crime is not the same because they was drunk.
All right.
Although your loved one get taken away.
Now listen, when we get to this side, I'm gonna need y'all to make y'all questions short, precise, to the point, because we're getting ready to quit. Real quickly, in the back. The microphone on in the back, please.
Hello?
Go on.
Hi, my question is about sexual assault that happens in prisons, because I have one cousin who's doing 25 to life and another one that just got out. Their father and son, actually. The one that's doing 25 to life is the father. He wrote me a letter one day and said that he had seen someone who was sexually assaulted. And his son, who just recently got out, said that nowadays you don't see it that often if it happens to someone that they're already homosexual. So I wanted to know your opinion on it, because nowadays, unfortunately, homosexuality is becoming accepted. So when a man comes forward and says that he was assaulted, he's not looked at as a victim. He's automatically labeled as a homosexual, and that may not be the case.
Any of your brothers want to comment?
I was considered a convict. Nowadays, they have inmates. And most convicts have rules and regulations which don't transcend regardless of time. And most of the guys who were in prison 30, 40 years, even going back, they would never engage in homosexuality. It was something considered appalling. Now the way society is, society does not really embrace spirituality. They want to do what feels good, and they push it into society. And unfortunately, you have individuals who are very young who are embracing these mentalities. They're going into prison. Now the sad part about it is that these guys go to prison, they engage in homosexual behaviors, and they come home and say that they weren't. And some of the sisters, who may not be as spiritual as they should be, but they're looking at the outward appearance of these men, say, oh, he's buff, oh, he has a job. It's a very superficial and fleshly way of thinking, but it's very harmful to the communities as a whole. And so each individual, unless it's forcible, like Maurice said, unless it's forcible, it's nothing that is embraced by hardcore criminals. It does transcend culturally. I've been in with guys from Venezuela who said, as a culture, anything after 5 years is considered free game. And the guys who were in with me, was, that is not anything that is embraced in our community or in the prison system we're in. But perhaps we can enlighten from a different angle.
All right. Go ahead. Another comment, brother?
Like in prison now, like back in the 80s when these two guys went through, that was normal. That was like literally normal. They had open showers. There was no stalls you go into. It's like this whole room showering at one time.
Right.
That was normal. You had people that preyed on people. So in that environment, some things have changed. But it's still pervasive to the point that where as though they have enacted laws that they do tests and stuff now. So any claim that something has taken place or, you know, they got hotlines now.
Right.
You could go grab the phone off the wall and say, this is what happened. Yeah, the Prison Rape Elimination Act. They have that in place now to where it's changed some, but it still takes place. And unfortunately, when it does, the person who suffers that gets looked at different.
Okay. All right, before I get some of you younger people, we have the older elder in front. We're going to go ahead and get Bishop Ferguson. Please bring the microphone to the front. We'll get Bishop Ferguson, and then we'll work our way back. Go ahead, Bishop.
Brethren, my question is related. I have two granddaughters, 20 and 6. And so my question really is on their behalf. What have you missed most? What is or are your greatest regrets? And if you had to revert your life again to 6 and 20 to avoid prison first and the prison within the prison, I'm talking about the whole, what would you do?
For me, I would say the biggest regret is actually taking someone's life, first and foremost. Because under no circumstances can you just put the law in your own hands or do what you want and just kill someone. You know, no matter what the... Because if things were without, like, much as some of us may have a disdain for certain police, you need them. Because it'll be anarchy. So you need law and order. But the biggest regret after that, you know, for me would be... There's a 23-year gap in my life, from 13 to 36, that's missing. So when you come back out, I remember one of my psychologists told me, she said that for that 23 years, you went from 13 to 36. So emotionally, you're missing a lot. So there's things that you may do. Like some, when I first came home, I got in the shower with shoes on. And that's not normal to shower with shoes, but we get so used to it in there that you'd be like, oh man, I gotta take my shoes off, you know? So some of the things you wish you can change, if you keep thinking about it, you'll cause yourself so much emotional distress, you wanna get out of that reality. So for me personally, I try not to keep thinking about what I would change. I just try to move forward and do things differently. Because if you keep going back and back, like I talked to my uncle the other day, I constantly go back to my grandmother's house. It's abandoned. No one's there. He said, you need to get away from it. I miss it so much, though. It's just I go back there. Every time I'm in that neighborhood, I go back there. And it causes me nothing but emotional distress. So for me, personally, I have to go forward. I can't go back.
Brother Webb.
Quick question. Please. This is in relation to the sexual assault that's in prisons. And if you could speak to the young brothers and sisters, those that carry the gun now, opposed to without men having a gun in prison, that they think that nothing can happen to them because they got the gun, they carrying the gun now. But once they step in the prison doors, can you just explain to them what effects and what can happen to them without the gun?
Well, when you get that door, it's a whole different attitude because it's ruled by administration. They ain't thinking about you having a gun. But the whole thing is, when you hit them walls, everything that you dealt with out here don't exist. Because they strip you as soon as you walk in there. They strip you of everything. Back in the day, they used to ask you where you wanted your body to go, because that was kind of jungle you was walking into. Where do you want your body to go to? So at the age of 18 years old, when I hit Greater Fort Pennsylvania, Penitentiary, they asked me, where did I want my body to go to? So when you look at these kids out here with these guns and things today, these type of conversations is needed for them to get a better understanding of it. And then, you know, you just got to keep it in God's hands after that.
All right, let's get the elder back here.
My name is William Smith. And I want to tell you them two brothers from Greaterford told you the truth. But they didn't get a chance to tell you all of it. All of you that have been in jail know that you don't know everything. And right now, I stand above everybody because I did 51 years in Greaterford. Right now, while we're sitting here talking, they're taking men in Greaterford every day, every day. They don't say nothing about it on the news or nowhere else. But 50, 60, 70 men go to jail every day, every day. And they just built a new one and closed Greaterford down, and the new one's called Phoenix. It's almost 10 miles long. It takes you 3 city blocks to walk, to go to eat. Almost 5,000 people feed every day. So there's a whole lot that you ain't gonna learn in this auditorium, and no time are you in jail for any time do you know everything.
All right, Brother Antoine, real quick.
First, I want to thank, I understand y'all brothers, the struggle. I also had life in prison and got it overturned. Real quick, intervention and prevention. For these young youth, the guys who did the juvenile, come in that juvenile, what was the consequence, the problems, the struggles that you had to deal with around cold-hearted convicts?
The biggest thing, you mix with men. A lot of people think that, well, they do have a new prison called Pine Grove but it's still men. Like, when they come through, you mix with grown men. So you could be 14 mixing with 40-year-olds. And that's probably what got you in prison in the first place. You learn more crime in prison than you do on the street. Like, you become a better criminal in prison. It's just up to you whether you're gonna utilize the bad stuff that you learn, or you want to utilize the good stuff that you learn. So this is why, like, a lot of laws were passed with rape and stuff, because a lot of kids were going in there. Instead of an older person from your neighborhood taking you under their wing, as we would say, they preyed on you. They found a way to act like they were your friend, buy you this and give you this and give you that. This was more so in their generation. My generation was like, we was a little bit more, like, we frowned upon a lot of stuff that was acceptable back in the 70s and the 80s. So when you're going in there that young, you like lost. And you don't understand that you're sentenced to die in prison. A few friends of mine personally, once they were sexually assaulted, they started doing it to other people. They started doing it to other people. Because they look at it as like, what was done to me, I want someone to feel my pain. So when you're young like that and you go in them environments, it's unfortunate because you can't call your mom. You can't call your dad. You can't call no one. And even if it happens, they might not even believe you and say, well, yeah, they'll put you in a hole for even bringing it up because they may say you're lying about it. So, you know, this is why it has to be outreach before they get there, especially the youth. Sometimes with older people, they've been told they may have been in and out. They get it. They just want to keep doing it over and over and over until they finally get it, like he said. He was doing it, and he said, you know, I got my life together. But as a kid, they may go in and never come out. And they be subjected to so much mental abuse and physical abuse where they normalize it because their brains is at a point to think that this is what's normal, and it's not normal.
I'm gonna ask no one else to stand. Let's make it short and quick.
Yeah, I looked on the news and I saw this woman. She had just finished her jail time and she went and voted, and they said she got 5 more years for voting. And she said she did not know that she couldn't vote. And I'm saying, are they doing anything to restore the rights that they took from y'all, you know, in reference to voting or anything like that?
Well, in Pennsylvania, I voted. As soon as I came home, I got my, I was a proud voter when I got, I'm voting, I got on my wallet.
You know, we can vote.
Yeah, I voted. I can vote now.
All right. Minor, make it quick, please.
Very quickly, I just want to commend you brothers for sharing everything that you're sharing. His home for me as of this day. I have a 16-year-old son that's in the streets, not going to school. Me and his mom is trying every intervention to get him into programs, online schooling. He's not participating. Since middle school till high school, he's been in fights, jumps. He's been stabbed, been in the hospital, and now he's in the street, just not abiding by anything that we're telling him to do. So right now, we have a program trying to get him acclimated with, just to motivate him towards education. And he's refusing all our intervention. My fear is everything that just spoke on was my fear. And I sat here and I cried. I had to leave to compose myself and come back. Because my fear is these streets gonna kill my son. He's only 16. Right now, DHS is involved, and we're given the chance for the program, but because the program knows so much about my son being suicidal, risk, and things of that nature, I think DHS is gonna step in and take my son and place him. So my question is to you, how confident are you guys about the system and trying to rehabilitate a young man that have a love for the streets, for the crime, he's doing drugs, having sex, doing all that that young people are doing that we're trying to avoid as parents, avoid him of doing. How confident are y'all with the system?
The system don't work. But that's the bottom line. It's your son, when they take your son, he's going to a place where it's a whole bunch of hymns. They got murders, they got attempted murders, they got robberies and everything that goes on. So he ain't gonna do nothing but become a better convict. You know, I did it. I'm one of them guys. I went to Slayton Farm Youth Study Center in my early life. You know what I mean? I thought I was doing something right. When I came home, I thought I was somebody, and I learned from the bigger people in these facilities. So I say to you, when they do take them, you and your wife stay involved. And if you can talk to Reverend Jennings or somebody and get somebody such as ourselves to help you with anything, please do, man, because our stories is real. And I ain't got no problem sharing it. I can bring Salim and he can do a little better too.
I think as the father, you got to say it's not going to happen. And you got to do everything possible. Because it's like, you know, one of my friend's mother, one of my friends asked his friend's mom, how did you stay married so long? And he said, don't get divorced. You know, don't let it happen, you know? And I think as a father, well, I don't have kids. I went to prison, I was 13 years old. So I couldn't imagine being in a situation where that type of decision was imminent in my life. But I will say that he's still out. DHS is involved, but okay. You can't let it happen. That has to be your mindset. I'm gonna do everything possible not to let it happen. And if it does happen, you look in the mirror and say, I've done everything possible not to let it happen. Because at day's end, somebody has to go to prison. It just don't gotta be your son.
Fight, right. Fight for your son. If you have to get on that internet every day, if you have to go to that courthouse, find out if there's a boot camp or something where they will take your son against his will, because he's a danger to himself and doesn't even understand it.
All right, what we got next so we can cut off, please. Come on, brother.
Greetings, my name is Perry, and I would like to know, after the crime have been committed and the realization all settles in, I would like to know for the youth and the adult, a lot of times they would like to repent and perhaps even be baptized. And I would like to know if there's some type of holiness church or something that they could actually, that they actually have been in the prison?
Yes, in all, well, in most prison facilities in Pennsylvania, it's very common to have like chaplains and no matter what your faith denomination is. The bad thing is, it's only one for 400 inmates that may have that particular faith. So, you know, it has to be up to the individual, because everybody need a little push. Everybody need that light to click on their head. Sometimes you got to turn it on, because everybody don't have the mental wherewithal to just say, I need to do something different. And all of us have had some type of spiritual reform to help us be better people. But it's up to the individual to make that choice. Because when you force something upon someone,
right,
they may not like it.
Right.
They may say, you want me to be this, and I don't want to be that. You know? And when they get older, they may even resent you for forcing them to be something that they don't want to be.
Exactly.
However, it's still up to the adult to say what I think is best for you. Mm-hmm. You know, because I think sometimes nowadays where you want your kid, you want your brother, you want someone to just do right, and you say, you know what, I got the answer for you. The answer may not be yours, especially in that environment when you got so many persons. There may be 2,000 people in certain prisons. Everybody got a different personality. Everybody finally got a different calling. So what wound up happening is you get 2,000 personalities all pulled in a different, you know, directions. It could be a chaplain all day long, or a priest, or whoever it may be. It's still up to the individual. But everyone needs a push. I don't care how the older guy just said, the gentleman, he been 51 years. You may know some things, but you don't know everything. That got to be the mindset. You may know a lot, but it's still some things you can learn. And that has to be the message to everyone. Just listen. This is why we have two ears and one tongue. Listen more. And that got to be the message to any and everyone, no matter if you reach 80 years or whether you reach 15 years. Listen, because as he said, the adults need to listen to the youth, and the youth need to listen to the adults.
All right, there's only three standing, the two young brothers and Zeke. Please make your questions short so we can bring it to an end.
All right, greetings, brothers. I have a question for you. You know, we all say, you know, for me with the phrase, you are what you eat. And I think that the rap music in today's society has a lot to do with the youth thinking and looking at life the way that they do. I know when you guys went to prison, the music was different. The wording was different. The spirit was different. This new generation, totally the opposite. It's about killing and shooting. And I'm from your generation, so when NWA came out and all the gangsta rap, I know how it made me feel. I didn't actually go do it, but if I had the opportunity, I can't say that I wouldn't. But that spirit, it's a spirit in that music. So my question to you is, how much do you think that the music today is affecting this generation in their wrongdoing?
I think the music is the number one influence of our youth. Long gone are the days of the Hibbit, and the Grandmaster Flash. Oh, those days are gone. Long gone are the days of KRS-One. Long gone are the days of Public Enemy. And unfortunately, the executives in the music industry do not want the youth to listen to anything educational. And a lot of times, our children are listening to music, and we don't even know what the music is. They're walking around the house with the cell phones on, the earplugs in. You ask them what they're doing, they don't know what you're talking about because the music is in their ears.
That's right.
And if they don't have a healthy self-esteem, if their self-esteem is not high, the music will tell them how to act, when to act, and who to act that way towards. See, the difference when you grew up in a two-parent household and you didn't get in trouble, but you listened to the music, your parents and your conscience were your checks and balance. You could listen to it. just like in the old, I mean, we know me and Mrs. Jones, that was about an affair. It didn't mean that every adult was running around having an affair because they had some respect for their wives. But the young people, they don't have that healthy self-esteem because of the generation they come from. And you're moldable to anything, whether you're watching it or listening to it, if your self-esteem is low.
All right, two young brothers.
Personally, with your experience, if you were talking to a kid, how would you tell him to say no to the streets?
By example.
Well said. Next young brother. Last one.
Hello. My name is Bob. I just appreciate you guys coming out and sharing your stories. A couple minutes ago, you guys talked about drugs and using it for escape. I know a lot of friends and even myself kind of suffer with that. So can you give some, some words of advice on how to steer away from using drugs as a form of escape?
I say, first, you got to start with the friends. You got to abandon them. Because it's either one of two things. Either you're leading or you're following. It's never the same. Like, you can't look at none of your friends and say we equal. Somebody's leading. Even if you felt equal, who get the last word? When you say, well, I don't want to get high, and he say, well, come on, man, like, you acting funny today. Can't be your friend. Because at day's end, your friend want what's best for you. So at some point in time, y'all gonna either grow apart because somebody's saying, you know what? I can't hang out with you no more. Every time I'm around you, I don't do nothing but get in trouble. Every time I'm around you, I'm in the cop car. Every time I'm around you, so it's like, why are we friends? You know? So, and it goes back to the parent as well, and back to what he, you know, said about the music. A kid can't normally do except what the parent allows him to do. Especially if the parent is paying for it. Some of the parents pay for their kids to listen to music. You bought the phone. You bought the game. So, at some point in time, the parent has to say, you know what? I bought it, it's mine, let me get it back. Now you gotta earn it. You ain't got time to get high, because your parents making you work now. You got dishes to do, you got a room to clean, you got a backyard to clean, you got a dog to feed, you got schoolwork to do. You ain't got time to get high. So I think the parent has to be the leader in that, because one, the kid probably ain't got money to buy it anyway. So where are you getting the money from? The parent giving it to him. Unless he's selling drugs or something. So just keep in mind, the people that's sitting up here did the exact same thing you did. And you don't want to tell all, you don't want to be the one sitting up here telling this story. Because it ain't fun at all, you know? So be the leader and say, you know what? We ain't friends no more. I don't care if you like it or not.
Last question.
All right, greetings, brother. Thank you very much for sharing your stories. I'm actually a school teacher myself. I got an opportunity to teach from kindergarten all the way up to 12th grade. My question to you all is, what do you think programs or anything that should be added to schools or that was taken away before or anything that could be a preventive measure from that school to prison pipeline?
It's unique that you say that you're a teacher, because think about it. Think about it when we was young. We had safeties. You know, safeties made you somebody. When they say you a safety, they made you a unique individual.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You had to put your hands out, hold up.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Don't go nowhere. They empowered us to be something. Mm-hmm. And then they took it all away. You know what I mean? They done took it away. And like when you speak about your kids, first thing you do is love them. You know, hold those conversations when they come share something with you. You know what I mean? Be that teacher that go outside the box. You know what I mean? Be that teacher, be that guidance, because a lot of them don't got it. You know, and that's what you got to do. We got to step up to the plate for these youths out here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, brothers. Go ahead, brother. Maurice, go ahead.
I think in regards to the school, and I think everybody in here can agree with that, they took God out of schools. It's actually illegal now to say one nation under God. indivisible with justice and liberty for all in school. They passed a law saying that you can't force, well, anyone needs so much as force. It was just a norm to accept God being in schools. So now that's taken out. So what are you replacing it with?
Exactly. We're glad for our brothers being here. Amen. Thank God for them. Now, let me say this. We're going to get ready to close and let you go. I got one last question that I need debunked. The young generation said the reason why they wear their pants hanging off their behind because our inmates do it. Is that true?
Not at all. Hey, we had a captain up Huntington. Every time we took a walk, if your pants was down, he'll take you right to that laundry room, get you a pair of pants that fit you, and put a belt on you. And then you got to keep in mind, if you had your pants hanging down, that means you was available in the penitentiary.
Exactly. So they didn't get that from the brothers in prison, did they?
Not at all. Not at all.
Now to our television viewers, again, we hope you enjoyed this. I'm telling you, you young men, you young men, pull your pants up, put your shirt down in them. We thank for our brothers taking the time out to come. We want to, I encourage you parents that is watching this live around the world, you share this conversation with your young people. The Bible says, when I was a child, I thought as a child and I spake as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Refreshments will be served after this meeting. Thank you for listening. Let us all stand, please. We're going to ask Bishop Ferguson to close us all out with prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this service today. We thank you for the lectures telling us about the way forward. We ask now, Lord, that you guide us, cover our young people and all peoples of the world. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray.